You're listening to the David Feldman Show, you happy, self-actualized hump.
Helaine Olen is back. Thank God. Thank God Helaine Olen is back. She is a columnist for The Washington Post. You should read her over at The Washington Post. She's also the author of Pound Foolish, co-author of The Index Card. I was reading the Sunday New York Times 2 days ago, and they had a whole investment section, and they accidentally sung the praises of Dave Ramsey, and I thought, oh dear, somebody needs to send Pound Foolish to the New York Times. Welcome back, Helaine Olen.
Wait, what article mentioned Dave Ramsey? I had no idea.
They were talking about where to get good investment advice, and one of the names mentioned was Dave Ramsey.
Oh, you have to send me that article.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. There are a lot of people out there who offer investment advice, as you learn by reading Pound Foolish, that all the investment advice out there is wrong. I would say 99% of all investment advice is wrong, Helaine Olen.
Well, definitely Dave Ramsey's is wrong, because he thinks people can get average annual returns of 12% in the markets, which is not true. Or at least hasn't been true as of yet. Certainly not average annual returns. You have a year or two. So I would say he's not the guy to go to for personal investment advice, definitively.
Yeah, and people are scared right now. I mean, you have taught us that nearly half the country can't come up with $400. This is beyond, I mean, it's just, you know, I don't even get started there. So the other half of America is being terrified that there's going to be a downturn in the economy. And, you know, what should they do?
They should do what they're doing. You should have a decent emergency fund. You should keep investing in the stock market through an indexed fund. Not individual investing. Do not go to anybody who says they've got the secret way to make sure you're going to be okay, be it gold, be it Bitcoin, be it, made-to-order furniture, you fill in the blank, right?
Mm-hmm.
Just keep doing what you're doing for the most part.
If you're doing the right thing, which is investing some of your money in an index fund, is what you're saying.
Correct.
But not all of it. Not all of it.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Not all of it, but, you know, a definitive proportion based on age. And all of your money, by the way, an index fund, whether it's an index fund, I mean, your investment money, not all your money, in an index fund for bonds, index funds for S&P 500, index fund for foreign stocks, and so on down the line.
Okay, I want to talk about your pieces in the Washington Post. They're absolutely incredible. Let me just ask you a question. This is... I read two pieces in the past week, and I thought of you. One is that inflation is over. The this time it's different phenomenon. But right before the economy crashes, you begin to hear this time it's different. And I've seen two this time it's different articles. One was in The Economist, that inflation is a thing of the past. We never have to worry about inflation, perhaps. And I either read this in The Economist, maybe The Washington Post or The New York Times, that the stock market is now immune to the ups and downs of the profit cycle because the Federal Reserve has gotten so good at fine-tuning the economy that it's almost impossible to see an economic downturn like we saw 10 years ago. So the this time it's different phenomenon is popping up now. That's not a good sign, right?
It's never different. That's the thing, right? It's never different. Inflation is fairly low right now, but I would point out that inflation actually on things like healthcare, housing, education, childcare is actually fairly high. So if you're, you know, if that's where your spending is, that the inflation on everything else is fairly low, it certainly is better than it not being, you know, that high, but it's definitely not quite as advertised that there's no inflation. Like, what we consider a victory in the healthcare sector right now is if, like, you know, premium advances are only double the rate of nominal inflation. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's absurd. I mean, that's utterly absurd. It is literally stealing Americans' salary gains at this point. People that nice health care insurance that you think you're getting for free from your employer, or that you're only like paying maybe $100 a month toward, actually your employer is probably paying about $20,000 for it, and you're just not getting it. I mean, so this is something that, you know, should be noted and flagged constantly.
Right. So let's talk about taxation without representation, one of your pieces over at the Washington Post. We have a Democratic Party that's debating tonight. Medicare for All is going to come up. Bernie says, I'm going to raise your taxes. And other candidates like Elizabeth Warren haven't really, you write, been upfront about whether or not they're going to raise taxes. And why is it okay to raise taxes in order to give us Medicare for All?
Is a sort of gotcha question in my view. And I don't condemn anybody for not answering it, because it's very clear to me that the people asking it are not asking it because they're genuinely concerned that this could raise taxes. They're trying to get a viral gotcha moment. Mm-hmm. In fact, as I pointed out, as I just said, Americans are paying a veritable fortune for their health insurance. The Kaiser Family Foundation, which studies this topic extensively, came out with a survey last month that said employers are paying on average over $20,000 a year for a family plan for their employers, and that most of that money is being paid by the employer, not the employee. This is money that if it's not a tax by the federal government, it is most certainly a tax by the healthcare sector, and which is the healthcare industrial complex, which is a for-profit, for the most part, business. And even when it's a not-for-profit, it's sure acting like a for-profit business. And you have no say in this matter. You really have no way of fighting back. Deductibles are soaring. The majority of people with employer-based health insurance now have deductibles in excess of $1,000. Family deductibles are obviously several thousand dollars. And this is money you're paying out. It amounts to a tax, yet you have never been asked what you think of it. You have never been asked to vote on it. You have no say in it, and you really have no way of fighting back against it.
Right. And when you negotiate a job with benefits, you are given, let's say you're given $50,000 a year, you're negotiating with somebody who thinks, well, if I'm paying you $50,000 a year, I'm really paying you $70,000 a year, because they're factoring in what the benefits are costing.
Right, and they are paying you $70,000 a year. You're not being taxed on all of that, but it is a tax because it is money that is not in your salary. The chances are incredible you would be receiving a lot of this money in salary if this burden did not exist.
How do you explain corporate America, which loves every government handout they can get their hands on? Why wouldn't corporate America view Medicare for All as a government handout? Wouldn't that solve?
I find this fascinating, because if you look at this just as a pure rational basis, business should be screaming for government to get this burden off of them. It is a massive weight on American competitiveness. It adds several thousand dollars to the cost of every car manufactured in this country. It is one of the reasons why, you know, our exports, you know, like our cars, you know, are less than competitive in some markets, is because of this weight. There is nothing you can do about it. It is just a weight. It is a weight that other countries are not paying. So there's two reasons. There's a simple reason and a more complex reason, in my view, that this is as is. The simple reason, of course, is that companies can, you know, write off some of the expense of the health insurance they give on their taxes, so it doesn't feel quite as bad to them as it should. But that still doesn't get around the fact of they're still paying all this money out, right?
Mm-hmm.
As somebody once put it to me, if you're, you know, writing it off on your taxes, you still spent the money. Okay.
Right, right.
But the second part is that you've got to wonder, you know, given that this so comes up in, you know, battles with workers, it's a big part of the current GM strike, for instance, that you've got to wonder if there is a desire to somehow control employees.
Yes.
People have job lock in this country.
Yes.
You know, people are very hesitant to challenge, you know, workplace rules over fear of losing health insurance. They're afraid to change jobs because the new health insurance could be worse. At the same time, of course, if you have built up seniority at one place, do you want to be the low person on the totem pole at the other? Because, of course, in that case, then you are, you know, you're at risk of losing your health insurance. And in this country, that's a massive hit if you lose your health insurance.
Absolutely. I just can't imagine somebody being that evil to say, you know, if I control your health insurance, I control your life. I'm not going to get any lip from you, because if I fire you, you and your family don't, they could die. And I like that power over you.
Right. And to be fair, I don't think people necessarily think of it that way, because as I always am saying, and I know I've said it here before, we always sort of, you know, rationalize our own best interests. So I'm sure these people wake up in the morning, and if they think about this when they wake up in the morning or whatever they think about it, they think, well, the American system is the best there is, because it's in their interest to think that. The American system, by the way, is not the best there is. There is, you know, while there is indeed access to incredible care in the system, it's done by biopsy, by wallet biopsy tests. You know, we don't, on all sorts of measures, from, you know, lifespan to infant mortality, we're middling at best and sinking rapidly. There is no rational world in which you would say this is the best system in the world.
Why aren't we seeing that? Remember the Women's March on Washington when Trump was sworn in?
Yes.
Why aren't we seeing that every weekend? I mean, you look at what's going on in Hong Kong or Paris, the yellow vests. Where are the Americans? Why aren't they marching every weekend?
I don't think any of us know the answer to that, because, you know, people should have been marching during the foreclosure crisis too. But I do think some of it is that while there's certainly a history that's all but forgotten of labor unrest in this country from roughly the 1870s through the 1930s, I think for the most part it's forgotten. It is not part of everybody's family background. America is a country where people have forever been encouraged to identify up and not down, which makes us somewhat unique. You don't see that in a lot of other countries. Most other countries, people don't, it doesn't work that way, as I think anybody who's traveled abroad or spent time abroad knows, is that people, you know, don't think they're going to become multimillionaires. What makes this ironic, of course, is that most of supposedly hidebound Europe actually has much greater class mobility than the United States, where we're all taught that, you know, we're just a good idea away from being a multimillionaire,
mm-hmm.
or a good savings habit away from being a multimillionaire. And I think that cuts into, I don't want to say it cuts into anger, because that's not quite true. God knows we're an angry country. But I think it cuts into people's willingness to fight back, because people blame themselves. And one of the fascinating things I have found when you read sociologists on this is that you see people really taking blame in a way that's kind of astonishing. You see this with Marianne Cooper has found this, where she studied people who are lower income in the Silicon Valley, who blame themselves for, you know, loose living when they're in debt. And then she says, what are you defining as loose living? And it's stuff like, well, I had to buy a new refrigerator. My old refrigerator was broken down.
Wow.
It couldn't be used anymore.
Wow.
I mean, like, what? Like, mm-hmm. what, they expect to use the icebox? Like, other sociologists have found the same thing. You see this repeatedly over and over again. And conversely, the wealthy can, while having a very vast understanding of what wealth inequality is actually doing, at the same time also will, you know, attribute their success to hard work, when in fact, you know, there's so much privilege going into it that it's, you know, yes, they might be working hard, but that's one of like 20 different factors, most of which are not fully in their control. I mean, what, we think poor people don't work hard? I mean, are you kidding? Like, have you ever like dealt with somebody who's doing manual labor? I mean, this is like astonishing that people think this stuff, but yet we do, and we do because we're encouraged in our society to identify up the economic food chain and not where we are or down.
Right, and pound foolish, you talk about how inherently good Americans are. The people in charge of us are not. And I was reminded of that last week when I was reading about PG&E, Pacific Gas and Electric, which is going bankrupt because of the Paradise Fire. And if you're a victim of the Paradise Fire, you should file a claim. And a lot of them aren't filing claims. And the reason is, well, I'm okay. I'm worried that if I get money, the people who really need it will get less.
That's right, which is what they're exactly what they're counting on, by the way. So if you were in the Paradise Fire and you're listening to this, go file your goddamn claim and do it yesterday, okay? Mm-hmm. But second, speaking of things that should have people out in the damn streets, PG&E is doing rolling blackouts. They don't want to invest in actually fixing their craptastic system that they were just milking for stock market returns for years. They are just doing rolling blackouts in California now, which is causing untold amounts of economic pain, might have resulted in at least one death. There's a guy who died when his oxygen tank got cut off last week. I mean, this is absurd that this is going on. And to be fair to the government of California, they're pretty furious about this. But again, it's like, this is not an acceptable answer. Where is everybody?
And the memory. I remember the rolling blackouts before 9/11 when Enron was playing with the energy market and California was losing energy. There were blackouts. And Dick Cheney was saying, well, we need to restructure our grid. There are problems with the grid. And, you know, the way California deregulated, this is what happens. This is what happens when you don't deregulate the energy markets. You end up with rolling blackouts. And then 9/11 happened. And then the Enron scandal happened. But we were so wrapped up in Iraq that we forget that we learned that those rolling blackouts were fake, that they were done right by traitors. There's audio of them saying, let's put some grandmothers in the dark right now, and they're laughing. Do you remember that?
Oh, I remember that. I almost got crashed into at a Santa Monica intersection with my then baby, now 20-year-old, in the back seat of the car because Santa Monica was impacted. You know what city didn't have blackouts? Los Angeles, because they never privatized their electric grid.
Wow. I didn't know that.
Yep. Yeah. Beverly Hills had problems, I think. Beverly Hills, Santa Monica, definitely. Los Angeles did not.
We don't understand where our food comes from, so they can tell us anything. We don't understand where our energy comes from, so they tell us anything. And we are literally powerless. We are powerless. I learned that before 9/11 when Dick Cheney lied. You know, George W. Bush was taking money from Enron. And Dick Cheney was blaming those rolling blackouts on regulations. And it was just a complete and utter lie. Education, yeah. The American people.
Speaking of other things we should be rioting over, I think I've written twice.
About Betsy DeVos?
Sorry, let me say this so I should repeat myself. I think I've written twice in the past 3 weeks about how Betsy DeVos once again gets my nomination for worst member of Trump's cabinet, which really is astonishing competition to win in. And whenever I write this, I should let you laugh. My husband says I always talk over laughing.
No, no, no.
It's People write me long arguments like, no, 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 Betsy DeVos is terrible, but this one is worse. And look, I'm going to say it right now. Yes, there are really horrible, horrible people in this group, okay? You know, separating mothers from children at the border, this is really horrible. And this is also, like, puts you in serious contention for the worst member of Trump's cabinet. Mm-hmm. The reason I consistently give the nod to Betsy DeVos, however, and I've been doing this pretty much since the beginning of Trump's presidency, is it really takes special doing, okay? This takes a special person to be born into one multimillionaire fortune, marry into a second. So you're basically a billionaire by the lucky sperm lottery and the lucky marriage lottery, okay? Mm-hmm. You know, privately educated, children privately educated, and to go around sticking a knife in public school students and, even worse, first-generation college students. This is horrible, okay? Right. This is like some ring of hell this woman belongs into that Dante has yet did not come up with. I mean, it's astonishing. And we think we live in a country where anybody can get ahead. I mean, the cynicism of this is staggering.
Right. Is it Corinthian?
I mean, it rivals Trump. I mean, it absolutely rivals Trumpian. And, you know, and she gets away with it over and over again. So the thing I wrote about two things she's done. Okay, she's not done one, but two. And one, to be fair to her, traces back to the Obama administration and to the second George Bush administration. So let me go over both of these. The first one that I wrote about is what's going on in the public service student loan debt forgiveness program. People who don't know, if you work for the nonprofit sector, or government or something along those lines, you're supposed to be able to get your federal student loans forgiven if you've worked for 10 straight years for this sector. Now, to be fair, the law was written very badly. The Department of Education, both under Bush and Obama initially, did not offer particularly good guidance in how it should be implemented, with the result that a lot of people got kicked off pretty quickly. So there's a lot of blame to go around here. However, okay, when the 10 years came up, it was Betsy DeVos who was in the winning chair in the game of musical chairs that this disaster has been, and not as a program itself, but in how it's been administered. And Betsy DeVos under her Department of Education, almost 97% of people who applied who thought they were eligible for this, okay? So they had held the job for 10 years, had believed they'd filed correctly, were told they hadn't. And it then turns out that, you know, the student loan processors, surprise, surprise, were giving people really bad information, enrolling them in the wrong programs, telling them that, you know, if they refinance their loans this way, they would continue to be eligible when they weren't, you name it, right? Congress gets involved and realizes that this is a major problem, right? And, you know, gets involved. It actually votes a pot of money, gets Trump to sign on to this, you know, a pot of money for the first year cohort to make good for these people, right? So they all go and reapply again in this massively convoluted process come up with by, guess who, the Department of Education under Betsy DeVos. Now, we know this part because the GAO did a study and said this is what happened, okay? So Department of Education comes up with this incredibly convoluted scheme, and surprise, surprise, what happens? Of the people who reapply, 99% are still rejected. Okay.
Wow.
There's a congressional hearing on this. People come up, you know, school teachers, first generation college students come up and testify and give their very sad story. Somebody from the Department of Education, because DeVos, of course, does not turn up like the coward she probably is, and actually calls what happened, quote, regrettable. Okay. Regrettable is when I spill red wine on a white dress, which is the sort of thing I'm a klutz, I do. That is regrettable. This is why I no longer buy white dresses. I mean, regrettable is not sticking a knife in the back of hundreds of thousands of college students or former college students who took low-wage jobs in the nonprofit sector because they thought, you know, this is a good thing to do and that their loans would be forgiven, right? Wow. They haven't been. This is people at, like, stated jobs that they would have otherwise moved on to, otherwise would have moved on from. They made life decisions based on this. They made financial decisions. And the Department of Education's like, F you, okay?
Right.
Not cool. All right.
Right.
This is why I think she's the most horrible person in Trump's cabinet. So, 3 weeks later, okay, I get another opportunity, because Betsy DeVos, if nothing else, gives you many opportunities to write the most horrible, who's the most horrible person in Trump's cabinet. This time, it is over Corinthian, which is one of these ghastly for-profit colleges that's now no longer with us, thank goodness, when, you know, it, where they enrolled students, most of whom were either first-generation college students or what they call non-traditional students, which is adults going back for a degree or going back for, you know, further education, military people, okay? This is not your kid who got a 4.0 who got a scholarship to Harvard, okay?
Right.
You know, so Corinthian gets shut down in 2015, or it goes bankrupt and shuts down, you know, basically with the federal government chasing after it because they've enrolled people under, you know, they've lied about job placement, they've lied about trading. They're just a real gem of the sector, okay? So people who went to the school are filing for forgiveness of their loans, which there's a provision in the federal law which says they can do that called defense to borrower. And to be fair, again, the Obama administration was not exactly on the ball with this initially, though they eventually came around on it and started forgiving loans. DeVos has all but tried to put a stop to this.
Right.
And so judges have told her, you've got to cut it out. This is the law. She has been told, you know, you've got to do this. So anyway, a judge put a stop to a lot of this about not quite a year ago, probably earlier this year. I think it was earlier this year. And anyway, P.S., what do you think happens? The Department of Education still continues, not for everybody, but for at least 1,000 people, still continues to seize tax refunds, garnish paychecks, and so on. So this all lands back in court with, yet again, in front of, once again, the wonderful federal judge, Sally Kim. And I'm saying wonderful not sarcastically, but meaningfully, because she lost it last Monday and basically threatened to send people to the Department of Education to jail unless they cut it out. Because the Department of Education once again tried to blame, guess who? The loan servicers, who just, you know, just happened to have trouble. Mm-hmm. You know, the loan servicers have more trouble than, you know, a mother with 16 children. They haven't gotten their act together in 20 years or 10 years. Why? Because it's in their financial interest to not get their act together, okay? So anyway, judge loses it, threatens people with jail. On Tuesday, she sends comes up with a written opinion, clearly has calmed down a little bit, doesn't mention jail, but starts mentioning serious sanctions. And, of course, the Department of Education is running around scrambling, saying, oh, my God, yes, 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 we're going to get this together. Yes, ma'am, we're going to do this. Anyway, once again, Betsy DeVos gets my nod for the most horrible member of Trump's cabinet, because torturing people who were ripped off by a for-profit college, most of whom were probably first-generation students or from some form of disadvantaged background, is really disgusting, especially when you're a billionaire.
Wow.
Have I ranted long enough?
No, I was going to ask you about her brother.
Eric Prince. Can you imagine being the parents of this crew?
Refresh our memory just very quickly, and then I'll let you go.
Blackwater. he runs mercenaries. He's involved in various Trump dealings with the Russians of sorts that I can't even quite follow. They're so complex and convoluted.
Right.
These are not good people, okay?
No,
I don't
know
what went on in this household. I don't want to know what happened in this household. But these are not good people. I mean, maybe the parents are really great people and this just happened because, you know, it does happen. But, I mean, this is really it's just sort of astonishing.
It is.
But this is our, you know, oligarchy. You know,
yep.
They're convinced of their own righteousness, and everybody else is, you know, it's your problem.
Yes. Well, Helaine Olen, I found you. I read you, and found you and invited you onto my show because you're a great writer. And my listeners should buy Pound Foolish because it's an easy read. It's a little infuriating. But it's an easy read. It'll get you angry, but it'll protect your money. Whatever you pay to purchase Pound Foolish, you will get it back in multitudes because you will learn how simple it is to save your hard-earned money from predators like the DeVoe family. You will learn how to stand up for yourself and say, if this doesn't make any sense to me, it's a scam. And I cannot recommend Pound Foolish. I've bought it for my children. You know, you can't tell people how to live their lives, but you can give them Pound Foolish, and it will teach them how to manage their own money. Or you can pick up the index card, which Helaine co-wrote. I talk about the complexity industrial complex, where people make things more difficult than they have to be to justify their paychecks. Your financial future can be reduced to an index card. So you should pick up Pound Foolish and the index card for people who you love. And, you know, we're how many years now since the Great Recession? 11?
If you count, it depends on how you're counting it. But if you're counting it from December of 2007, which is the technical start date, we're coming up on 12 years.
We're coming up on 12 years.
Actually, 12 years. But most of us think of it as the crash in 2008, right? In September of 2008. So that puts it at 11 years.
So
but
we're in
the technical start date is December 2007.
And we are
And by the way, I'm not saying this to like make anybody scared because I'm not into stock market predictions, but I will point out that you could go to October of 2007 when the stock market was hitting new highs every day and people thought everything, you know, this time was different yet again.
Right. This time
I know because I pulled a lot of those for Pound Foolish.
Right. So. And I'm saying this time is different. So not to scare anybody.
So, you know, hey, but this time, as I say, could be different, on the other hand, because Australia has not had a recession in 27 years, as I'm always reminding people. So, hey, it could really be different.
It's never different.
But the prediction business is not
right.
a good thing.
Thank you so much. Can you read Helaine Olen at the Washington Post and pick up those two books? Thank you so much. Can you stay in line for one quick second?
Okay, thanks.
Okay, all flight controllers, go now, go for landing. Retro.
Go.
Fido.
Go.
Guidance.
Go.
Control.
Go.
Telcom.
Go.
GNC.
Go.
Ecom.
Go.
Surgeon.
Go.
Capcom, we're go for landing.
Eagle Houston, you're go for landing. Over.
Roger, understand. Go for landing. 3,000 feet.
You're listening to the David Feldman radio program, You Sad Pathetic Hump.
Joining us is Howie Klein. He is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC, raises money for progressive and some socialist candidates around America. Howie, I have some information on music. Somebody contacted me and said he's getting to work on a theme song for Howie Klein on this show. I made the mistake, thinking I was nurturing new talent, I made the mistake of saying, don't worry about it being good or bad. Just make something and we'll either like it or not and then make another one. Is that bad advice to give to a musician?
I don't know. I mean, it depends on who you're giving it to, but probably they understand where you were coming from and I wouldn't worry about it.
Yeah. I think you should fail. And if you accidentally make something good, it's a hit. But don't worry. Do the best you can.
Yeah, that's all they can do is the best they can.
Okay.
I can't wait to hear it.
Well, get to work and you know who you are. So I thought I had gossip for Howie Klein. And it turns out he already knew about Jeffrey Epstein and Wexner, the former CEO of Victoria's Secret.
The reason I know is because everyone in Ohio talks about that. He lives there, and it's just been, you know, it's just a well-known fact there.
because I was talking to a friend of mine who knows everything, and he said, I said to him, well, how is it possible that somebody like Wexner, who ran Victoria's Secret into the ground, apparently, how was it that they gave power of attorney?
More than Victoria's Secret. I mean, he had a big empire, and he's one of the richest guys, or the richest guy, I can't remember, in the whole state of Ohio, and a major, major figure in the state's politics.
And the Limited, he ran the Limited. And how did he give Jeffrey Epstein power of attorney? How did Jeffrey Epstein get his hands on all this money? And now it turns out that people are saying there's talk that he and Jeffrey Epstein were involved with one another.
Oh, wait a second. Okay, so you're telling me things I didn't know. What I knew is that he was a client of Jeffrey Epstein's.
No. So I do have gossip for Howie Klein.
Yes.
The student has become the teacher.
Oh, please.
The word, the rumor that I heard, and again, this is just conjecture, is that Jeffrey Epstein and Wexner, the owner of The Limited, he and Wexner were more than just business associates.
They were both spying for the Likud? I don't know, whatever.
Oh,
right. Wexner is Jewish as well, right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, so is that the rumor that they were both working for the Mossad?
Well, if that's a euphemism for Pickle Park.
No, it's not.
No, I don't think it has to do with Mossad.
It has to do with, like, whitening their teeth?
They were both whitening each other's teeth, yes.
Oh, I had no idea. I didn't know that.
Okay. Now, this is what I was told from a very reliable source. And he's never misled me before.
Wow. Okay. Well, very interesting. You know, there was always a connection between them. And Wexner is a major donor to the Republican Party in Ohio, particularly. And he would be exactly the kind of person that the Mossad would be targeting. And since it's kind of assumed now generally that Epstein was a Mossad agent, I could see why there would be some kind of a bond between the two. I had never heard anything about either one of them being gay.
He was an agent for Mossad doing what? Getting compromise on persons of interest for Israel?
Yes. I mean, I don't know. No one ever told me what it was about, what he was specifically about. But, you know, you can imagine if he's running a major, operation supplying young girls to high figures in American society, whether they were political or business figures or whatever, that he was getting a lot of information that could be used.
Mm-hmm. And there seemed to be a revolving door that went from Jeffrey Epstein to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation.
Oh, I didn't know about that either. That's horrifying.
That was in the New York Times. That there's a doctor who in medical school was working for Jeffrey Epstein, another doctor who was friendly with Jeffrey Epstein, and they went to work for the Bill Clinton Foundation. And Bill Gates. Did I say, yeah, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. And
so you did say the Clinton Foundation by accident, which is funny because they do have a lot of, interesting stuff going on there as well.
Yeah. Bill Gates, Microsoft, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. He was flying on Jeffrey Epstein's plane a couple of times. And a lot of people, a lot of top scientists came from Jeffrey Epstein's tutelage.
Yep. He was Epstein was always trying to, kiss up to scientists as well as business people and politicians and authors and everyone who might be an influencer. He was always trying to get together with them and sort of lure them into his little honeypot. And in fact, a friend of mine who's a scientist and an author told me how that happened at his university, and telling me a lot of the people went for it, and he and many others didn't go for it.
Mm-hmm. It was in the New York Times, I think, yesterday or 2 days before. The other thing that I found really disturbing was that Jeffrey Epstein was pitching a hedge fund to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. He said he can get billions and billions of dollars, and we can pull them, and there'll be investments solely in ending world poverty. And Epstein was somehow going to make $30 million a year. He was going to get a piece of this hedge fund that Bill and Melinda Gates were considering. And it's the idea that through capitalism, you know, you can do well and do good. It's just the lie that you can invest your way out of climate change and AIDS and world hunger. All it takes is just some good investments. And it's an article worth reading. Let's talk about Bill Barr, sir, unless you want to respond to that.
No, I have nothing to say about it.
Okay. There's no doubt in your mind that somebody like Bill Barr, the attorney general, decided that for the good of the country, Jeffrey Epstein had to go. More and more people I know who don't traffic in conspiracy theories are convinced that it was best for everybody if Jeffrey Epstein disappeared.
Well, that would be if you consider the country Donald Trump, as he does, and if you consider everybody Donald Trump, as he does. I mean, I know, like, in France, you know, when Louis XIV said, "I am the state," that was not an odd thing to say. That's the way it was.
Mm-hmm.
The king was the country. It was the same thing. And that's been the case for a long time. In fact, I was thinking about that today, how they're going to sanction Turkey. And I mean, it would be a lot better. I mean, the Turkish people shouldn't necessarily be made to suffer for what Erdogan is doing, or for what Erdogan and Trump cooked up.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel bad about the Turkish people. I've spent a lot of time in Turkey many, many, many years ago, starting in 1969 and right up until last year. And I love Turkey, and the people are great. And they've been a really good ally to the U.S. And, I mean, even, like, you know, sending troops to Korea, and they have no fight there, but the Turks did. And now Trump is saying he's going to crush the whole economy, after giving Erdogan the green light to go in and take over the Kurdish enclave in the north of Syria. So, you know, and I was writing about it for tomorrow and saying, you know, I hope or I wish that we had a strong State Department where they could counsel him, you know, to tread lightly and to aim at Erdogan and his party and the people around him, not you know, put things on that are going to be a disaster for the whole country. But you know, Trump and Erdogan both, they see themselves as the embodiment of the state, which is very non-democratic, to put it mildly.
And is there any justification for doing what he did? For just saying, giving the green light to go in to Erdogan?
Is there any justification for Trump?
Yeah.
No, there's not. I mean, this is something that Russia very much wanted. They've always wanted to drive a spike through the American-Turkish alliance. It's right, you know, Russia is their neighbor, and Russia has always coveted the ice-free ports of Turkey, because they don't have any ice-free ports.
Hmm.
And, you know, the other thing is there are 50 nuclear weapons in Adana. American nuclear weapons, and Russia has been, you know, eager to get them out of Turkey, and they've been hoping for that, and I'm sure Putin has told Trump that's a goal, and that's going to happen now. Those 50 American nuclear weapons are going to be removed from Turkey.
Who's removing them, Trump or Erdogan?
Well, Erdogan can't, but Trump, if he can, I mean, he will ask. I mean, the Pentagon, I don't know that Trump has the brains to remove them, but the Pentagon wants them out of there. They feel that the situation is too dangerous now. Adana is right near the border of Syria, and they feel the situation is unstable. There are only, I believe only 5,000 American troops there, and, a small handful of British troops, and the Germans all left already. And, there's going to be very big sanctions put on Turkey, according to Trump, but also now Pelosi and Lindsey Graham are getting together to bumble into this thing as well. And, they're talking about overturning Trump's order. Well, he's the commander-in-chief. You can't overturn his order. It's insane. I mean, what Lindsey Graham should do is join Nancy Pelosi in impeaching that idiot.
Right.
That's the way
right.
you will overturn his order. You make him not commander-in-chief anymore.
Right.
Which they could do very easily now. But, to countermand his order and send troops back into Syria, that's insane. I mean, he is the commander-in-chief. Shouldn't be, but he is. And you want to countermand his order, get rid of him as a commander-in-chief. In other words, impeach him and remove
right.
him.
Right. Although it would be interesting to pass a war resolution and force the commander-in-chief to fight a war. I don't think he'd try to win it. You're right. It would have to be impeachment.
It would have impeachment. Meanwhile, yeah. Russia wanted those nuclear weapons gone from Turkey. They're going to be gone now. I mean, the Pentagon is trying to get them out of there. You just can't like put them on a bus and take them away. You've got to, it's a big deal getting even moving one nuclear weapon. But imagine what kind of precautions have to be taken when you're moving 50 nuclear weapons in a very volatile area like that.
A couple of years ago, I was reading about the Cuban Missile Crisis, and
it's very funny you should say that. This is related.
Well, go ahead. How's it related?
Because the deal that the Russians wanted was, we'll take our nuclear weapons out of Cuba, you take your nuclear weapons out of Turkey.
Exactly. But nobody knew about that. That was a secret deal that Bobby made. As I remember reading, he negotiated.
I think it was supposed to be a secret, but it didn't last as a secret. I mean, the secret was out of the bag when I was still a kid and remember it.
And the idea was, the legend of Camelot is Khrushchev blinks, he removes the missiles, and then in a year, America will secretly remove the missiles from Turkey. But that wasn't supposed to be revealed to the world. It was a secret deal. So apparently...
Okay, but it didn't last as a secret. It didn't stay a secret. And the U.S. Nuclear force in Turkey never got moved. I mean, it may now get moved. I mean, imagine... if Kennedy made this deal, look how long it's taken for it to finally happen. And it took Putin... getting Trump into the presidency to make it happen.
Okay. Before we get to, I want to ask you about impeachment, and then I want to talk to you about the Electoral College and Trump's chances. But let's stay on Bill Barr for a second, the Attorney General. He spoke at Notre Dame Law School over the weekend. What did he say?
Wait a minute. Why did you correct yourself when you said Notre Dame? It is Notre Dame.
I feel this is, I swear to you, this feels like deja vu. I feel like we've had this, I'm having a moment of deja vu where I thought I mispronounced Notre Dame. Is it Notre Dame or Notre Dame?
It's Notre Dame.
And is it win one for the Gipor or one win one for the...
it's the Gipper.
Oh, okay. At Yeshiva, it's one mean, win know, one I mean, for Yom Kippur, but that's a whole. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Anyway, so Barr basically said a few different things that were important. I mean, what I thought of from what he said was that was important was that he was basically getting involved with like religion, which you don't think that the Attorney General is going to get involved with. He was trying to stoke some feelings of grievance among white evangelicals. That's what it sounded like to me. But it was funny. I was at an event yesterday, an evangelical event for my favorite evangelical group, Vote Common Good, and Lou was one of the speakers. And they asked Ted about this as well, and he went off on a completely different tangent about Barr's lawlessness and just left out the whole religious part. There's another part of what he said as well. I only sort of got into the religious part myself. That was the part of the speech that I watched and was freaked out about.
Bill Barr.
I'm surprised at Barr's speech, yeah.
Yeah, Barr, his father was Jewish, Bill Barr, who hired Jeffrey Epstein at Dalton. But he was raised, I think, Catholic.
Are you joking about Bill Barr's father being involved with Jeffrey Epstein?
Bill Barr's father ran the Dalton School and hired Jeffrey Epstein to teach calculus when Epstein was about 21 or 22, without a college degree.
Amazing.
Yeah.
The
students remember Jeffrey Epstein at Dalton. They say he would show up to some of their parties. You know,
looking for girls or bringing them?
I don't know, but a lot of the students say they remember Jeffrey Epstein showing up. He was that, you know, he was that priest who could, you know, he could always talk to you. You could always talk to that priest. He was that guy. Yeah. Your friend got kicked out of the, what was the evangel, the voters?
The Value Voters Summit.
Yeah, what is the Value Voters Summit? Doug Padgett was there, and he's a preacher?
But he's an evangelical pastor in Minneapolis. He's a very, very, very progressive evangelical pastor, mildly. And he was talking with some other pastors. They were saying something. When he said he was from Minneapolis, they started like saying horrible things about Ilhan Omar being his congressperson. And he wasn't on the down low or anything. He was upfront about who he is and what he does, and he defended her. He likes her very, very much, and he defended her. And first they thought he was joking, and and then they realized he wasn't, and then they looked into it a little further and they got him kicked out.
They kicked him out. And who was speaking there? Ralph Reed? The Usual Suspects?
Yes, the Usual Suspects. And the keynote, or not the keynote, but the guy who closed the whole thing out was Trump. This is a big deal. The Value Voters Summit is an annual thing. What it really is it's a, you know, they try to, you know, put some patina of Christianity on it. It has nothing to do with that. It's a Republican Party event. That's all it really is.
Okay. Let's talk about the impeachment. You write over Down with Tyranny that you can see Trump being impeached and then getting reelected.
Impeached in the House.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the House will impeach him. The Democrats have enough votes to do that without even any Republicans. Or they may get a couple. I doubt it, but they could. And there's already an ex-Republican, independent Justin Amash, who has already said he'll vote for impeachment. I think he said it, or if he didn't say it, he implied it.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I see maybe two or three or four Democrats who won't do it. So they can impeach him. Then it goes to the Senate. And in the Senate, there's a couple of different paths it may take. But it really does come down in the end to a vote. And there are a few ways to do this. So let's just say that McConnell lets it go through and lets there be a full debate, and you know what they call it is a trial. So let's say McConnell says, okay, let's have a trial. Or even if he fails to do what I think he's going to do, which is to try to say, well, there's no merit and we dismiss this out of hand. Mm-hmm. And then there would be no trial, no debate, nothing. I think he'll try that, and he may succeed. Or I think he'll fail. So say he fails and there's a trial. So everyone says, well, the Democrats can never get him removed because you need 67 votes. Well, actually, you don't need 67 votes. What you need is 20. I'm sorry. What you need is 2/3 of the members who are there, not 2/3 of the members who exist. 2/3 of the members who are there that day. Hmm. So, if everyone is there, then you need 67 votes. That's 2/3 of 100. But say, if 30 Republicans don't show up, the Democrats have enough members to remove him. They don't need the Republicans to vote with them. They just need them to not come. So there are a couple of ifs about this. And it's funny because I told this to Ted Lieu last night. He didn't know about this either, and he was very surprised himself. That's the way that piece of legislation is written. But the problem with it, there are a couple of problems with it. So there are three Democrats who voted to confirm Bill Barr. They're three of the most conservative Democrats in the Senate. They are Joe Manchin from West Virginia, Doug Jones from Alabama, and then Kyrsten Sinema from Arizona. They were the only Democrats to vote to confirm Bill Barr. They are the only Democrats that anyone thinks might possibly vote against impeachment. If any of them do, that whole theory that I just said goes down the tubes, because then the Democrats won't have enough votes. But just say for a minute, just for the sake of argument, that the three of them decide, okay, we will vote for impeachment. Then you need 30 Republicans. Well, I just tore whatever hair I have out trying to think of what Republicans could possibly go along with this thing. And, I mean, this is how deep I went. I even included Ted Cruz as a possibility. There are some Republicans that if you could show them that Trump will be removed if they vote with their feet and don't come, that they won't be afraid, because you've shown them, okay, this guy, you're the 30th guy, and he's out. Then they would do it. And that's not going to happen. I mean, it's just, first of all, even with a guy like Ted Cruz, I'm stretching, you only get the 27 possibilities. So it can't happen. So that's why I wrote that piece saying that, yes, he'll be impeached, but no, he will not be removed. There's nothing that they can do to remove him. It just will not happen. There aren't enough Republicans who go along with even something as moderate as just not showing up that day.
Right.
It cannot happen.
So over down with Tyranny, you have the story where you say he can't be removed, and theoretically he could be reelected. However, the next story you have is about his chances of getting reelected, and you do a state-by-state analysis, and you write that you have never seen a president in such bad shape with the polls.
Right. That's right. So what it is, it's not much of an analysis, to be honest with you, but what it is how underwater he is, or not underwater, in each state. So it's all 50 states. And let me just preface that by saying this. He is, from the time he was elected until now, there's only one state where he's not down by double digits. He's down in every state. He's not up in any state. He's down. Mm-hmm. And in most states, he's down by a lot. I didn't really do the mathematics, but it looks to me like he's down by about an average of 20 points. And that's counting even states that like him. But the only state where it wasn't a double-digit loss, the only state he could look at and say, well, see, they don't hate me that much there, is Idaho, where he's down by 9 points, which is amazing.
When you say down by 9 points, in other words, his approval rating has dropped 9 points in Idaho since he first took office.
It's a net of 9 points. So what you do is you take the approval rating minus the disapproval rating, or the opposite. So 9 points is in the case of Idaho, they still like him, but he's down 9 points, and so they don't like him much. I mean, they're getting to like him less and less. But Idaho doesn't matter. I mean, you know, aside from the fact that Idaho has four electoral votes, Idaho is not on anybody's scheme to win back the White House by winning over Idaho. That is very, very unlikely anyway. But all the states that Trump does need to win, he's underwater in those states.
Okay.
So in other words, he's underwater in Florida. He's underwater by huge numbers in Wisconsin, Iowa, Michigan. He's underwater by 5 points in Ohio. I mean, it looks so bad for him now that he must be just doing anything to try to get everyone's attention diverted from this. You know, a good little war should, you know, he probably thinks will help him. But it's like no one likes the guy, and less people like him by the day. The more he does, the more they see of him, the more he's on TV, the more they don't like him. I mean, he went crying to Fox this weekend, saying, "You know, you're ruining me. I can't have this. You cannot be putting me in this bad light." That's Fox.
Well, at what point does the Republican Party no longer belong to Donald Trump?
Ah, good question. So that is not about national numbers at all. That goes back again to these state-by-state numbers. And when you start to see Republicans feeling that they're threatened in any serious way in their own districts, when we talk about the House, or in their own states when we talk about the Senate, that's when it doesn't belong to him. In other words, there are some states. No, let's talk about Congress. There are some districts where you don't need independents to win. There are enough Republicans that all you need to do is hold on to your base, your Republican base, and all the Democrats in that district and all the independents in that district, they can all vote for someone else or not vote at all or whatever, and you still win. But there aren't that many of them. There are some. Mm-hmm. But there could be. I mean, I've predicted that there will be about 50 Republicans who lose their seats. That's a lot. That's really a lot, especially after we had the last anti-Republican wave in 2018, where they lost about 40 some odd seats, and now to lose even more than that's historic, and I think that's going to happen. I really do see that happening. If there was no DCCC, it would unquestionably happen.
Right.
But because there's a DCCC that interferes in the choice of nominees, we're going to wind up with some nominees that will probably not win because, you know, people don't want these ultra conservatives that the DCCC is recruiting. You know, the DCCC they have no problem having anti-choice and anti-gay and anti-immigrant not only do they have no problem recruiting candidates like that, they want candidates like that. They'll do their best to have candidates like that. So that's a problem. If they didn't exist, we got 50 seats.
Okay, you wrote over Down with Tyranny. I was shocked by this. In 2018, in the Senate races, 52 million Americans voted for a Democratic senator. Only 34 million voted for a Republican senator. Now, because of geography and the layout and the election cycle, the Republicans were able to keep the Senate. But that should be worrisome for the Republicans in 2020.
They are very worried, yes. They're very worried about 2020, and they should be. You know, they have a lot of seats up for grabs. Trump's going to be on the top of the ticket. He's very unpopular, and you know they don't know what to do. I've said before they're in a trap. If they denounce Trump or are negative towards him, then his Republican base is going to turn on them. And if they don't do that and they defend Trump to keep that Republican base, then independents won't vote for them. And that's the problem, especially when you get to states where independents are the determining factor. And you have a lot of states this time in play where that is the case. So it's not the case in Mississippi. It's not the case in Alabama. You don't need independents to win there. Republicans don't need independents to win there. but you're not going to win Maine without independence. You're not going to win Colorado without independence. You're not going to win Arizona without independence. And those three states all have weak Republican incumbents who are up for re-election. You know, even in people aren't talking about Montana at all. But even in Montana, where you have a Republican incumbent, Trump is down by a few points. More people don't like him than like him. And that makes a problem for Steve Daines, the Republican incumbent. What's he going to do? How is he going to handle it?
And you write Texas. He's way down in Texas, Trump is.
Well, no, he's down from where he started in Texas. He's still Texas is about even. You know, it's about the same number of people like him and don't like him. I suspect the survey that I was looking at, which is put out by Morning Consult, was put out in the middle of September. So it was really before all the Ukraine stuff. And, mm-hmm. and I suspect that when the new numbers on Texas come out in a few weeks, that Trump will be underwater in Texas. I don't know that for sure. I'm just guessing. But looking at the way they do their polling and the way people respond, this Ukraine thing is going to hurt him quite a lot. I mean, there was something that came out today that showed that 62% of Americans think that he was wrong to have that call with the president of Ukraine.
But they're not necessarily certain he should be impeached for it.
Right. They're not. But right. But it's the opening salvo. You have to start somewhere, and that's a pretty serious number.
And it moved very quickly.
Right. But remember, when you say 62%, that includes that world of polling includes Trump diehards. So when you're saying 62% are opposed, you're talking about basically all the Democrats and a very substantial number of independents who tend to be kind of wishy-washy on these things, and they're not very wishy-washy on Trump right now.
And it hits home in Texas because Lev and Igor, as you call them, they donated money. Lev and Igor were Giuliani's associates. They were arrested last week. And
they're in jail now. They can't make bail. It's $1 million bail each because they caught them trying to flee the country with one-way tickets.
Right. And they gave money to Pete Sessions.
Well, they don't have money of their own. They funneled money. They funneled Russian money into the Republican Party. And people don't understand what they did. So Pete Sessions can get away with saying, hey, I'm giving back the money. You know, and he could write a check to a charity for $20,000 because they gave him directly $20,000, a little more than $20,000. But the $20,000 didn't mean anything. What really meant something is they took $3.1 million worth of rubles, and they put it into a super PAC for him, just for him. So this, in other words, the super PAC did other things, but that $3.1 million was only for Sessions. And they ran advertising, smearing his Democratic opponent and doing good things for Pete Sessions. So by the way, let's remember we're talking about a very, very influential, powerful Republican congressman who at the time when he was defeated last year was the chairman of the Rules Committee and had previously been the head of the NRCC, the Republican version of the DCCC. So he's a very, very powerful guy, and he was defeated in his own North Dallas district. And he was one of the people who helped convince Trump, who didn't need a lot of convincing anyway, to fire the American ambassador to Ukraine. That's why they gave him the money. And that's why they put a little over three, let's just call it $3 million, so I don't keep on explaining it's 3.1. So let's just say it's $3 million into the super PAC to smear his opponent. It didn't work. The opponent beat him.
Right.
And so he's out of a job. So now he's decided
he lost to a Democrat.
Sorry?
Well, it's important to point this out before we talk about Texas 17, that Pete Sessions, Republican, representing Texas 32 for at least 20-some-odd years.
21 years.
He was getting all this money from Levin Igor.
Right, Levin Igor.
And yet he still lost to Colin Allred, a Democrat.
Right. He was someone who worked in the Obama administration, plus he was a football player, and not a good congressman, not anything. He's just like a nothing. He sits there. He's the furthest back bencher that you'll find. He's as far back as you can go
okay.
in the stands.
Here, but I'm kind of curious about this. We know, I read this over at Down with Tyranny, that Pete Sessions has been filthy since Jack Abramoff, that every scandal...
He's been filthy even before Jack Abramoff, but he was caught in the Jack Abramoff scandal, and then he was caught again in the Alan Stanford scandal. So two of the biggest scandals that have been in Congress since he came in, he was in the center of both of them, and in both cases with very large amounts of money. So this guy is not an unknown to corruption. He is he has always been one of the most corrupt guys in Congress, and now he thinks he can get away with just giving back $20,000, but doesn't even want to mention the $3 million because, well, I didn't get the $3 million. I can't help how they spent the money.
Mm-hmm. And you say that he's running now in Texas 17.
Right, which is a redder district, but it's not prohibitively red. It's a district that's changing. It includes Waco, which is a more of a red part of the district, and happens to be where he was born as well. But it's not near where he lives or where he's been a congressman from. It's quite a bit further south. And the congressman from there, a Republican congressman from there, named Bill Flores, had a tough time winning last time and realizes that it's just a matter of time before he's defeated. So he decided to retire. So it's an open seat. And Flores was furious that his comrade, they've worked together many, many years, Pete Sessions is trying to come into the district, and he's saying, no, we have enough Republicans who live here and who know the district and have been part of this district, and he's tried to discourage Sessions, and Sessions doesn't care. He just wants back in. He feels he can win that seat, and I don't know if he can or not, but there is now a bitter war inside the Republican Party over Pete Sessions trying to get back in, which may give the Democrat who's running a little bit of a chance. Again, he's, just another middle-of-the-road kind of Democrat. He's nothing to get excited about.
Okay. Can you spare a few more minutes?
Yeah, of course.
Okay. All right. So I'm trying to understand Levin Igor, who were arrested last week. They are associates of Giuliani's. And as I understand from reading Down with Tyranny, Levin Igor funneled dark money from Russia to
millions and millions of dollars of it. Yes.
And it's
and you don't know where it went. I've really been looking into this since July, trying to figure out how much and where, and it's almost impossible to figure because a lot of it is secret, and it goes here and it goes there and it winds up doing a lot of bad stuff. Some of it, like the $20,000 that they specifically gave Sessions, you can follow. But the $3 million, that was very, very hard to figure out, and where it was going to be, how it was going to be spent, all that was very difficult. It wasn't impossible, but it wasn't easy. And then when it comes to state money, very, very hard for me anyway, for my skill set to figure that out. And one of the ways I saw it, for example, was because they wanted marijuana licenses to sell marijuana. Mm-hmm. And so they started pumping money into local Republicans in different states. And I noticed that the governor, the Republican governor of Florida, announced the other day that they gave him $50,000 and he's turning it over to charity.
Right. And that is money laundering. You're taking money. It's against the law.
Yes. Legally. Russia.
It's against the law for a foreign government to give money to a federal candidate.
Or a state candidate.
Or a state
candidate. They don't have to put any money into American elections. And the way they did it was through these two former Soviet, they're born in the Soviet Union, and they're now American citizens. They were taking money illegally from the Russian government and putting it into, for example, Trump's campaign through a super PAC, although they also maxed out to Trump personally, but they put hundreds of thousands of dollars into, that I know of, into a super PAC to help Trump, the same way they did with Jeff Sessions. They also gave very large sums of money to about, as far as I know, I mean, it could be more, definitely not less, but about 15 or 16 different state parties, like the New York State Republican Party and, you know, the Arkansas State Republican Party. So they were putting money into the Republican apparatus. Someone was telling them where to put the money. They weren't randomly putting money. They were just, you know, trying to enrich the Republican Party with Russian money. And what do you get? Hey, you get Trump, like, you know, doing some kind of cockamamie thing that's going to result in a big Russian win for something they've been trying to get for decades, which is U.S. nuclear weapons out of Turkey.
Okay, I just got an email from Nick, who's working on your theme song. I just got it. He says he was up in the sticks on a gig. He wants to get Howie's fake and real songs done this week. When will he be on this and next week so I can set some deadlines? All the best, Nick. Well, he's on every Tuesday. So get to work, Nick. As you were talking, it came across. The debates tonight. I thought Bernie's interview with ABC News on Sunday was brilliant. He very politely said there is a difference between me and Elizabeth Sanders. She is a capitalist. I am not. What did I say? Elizabeth Sanders?
Mm-hmm.
Elizabeth Warren. I thought that was brilliant. What do you see?
I thought he did a good job on that as well. And I was happy to see the way he did it. He was respectful of her. And, you know, he made clear where he stands. And, you know, she has said over and over and over that she's proud to be a capitalist. And he made it clear that he's a socialist and that that's the difference between the two of them.
And would you like to see Elizabeth Warren's Medicare for All plan?
Sure.
She doesn't really have one yet, does she?
She shouldn't have one of her own, but she has signed on as a co-sponsor to his.
Okay. I'm surprised, Howie Klein, that you're not more... I'm surprised how sympathetic you are to Elizabeth Warren. But to be continued next week.
I like her very much.
Okay.
I mean, I'm a Bernie guy, but, you know, if she winds up winning the nomination, I'll be sad that we don't have Bernie, but I'll be really happy that we have her.
Okay. It'll be interesting.
She's not like Hillary. She's not like Biden. She's very much not like those people.
Okay. Here's a debate question that I think is going to be asked. They're going to ask Joe Biden why his son quit that Chinese firm. If there was no there, then why didn't he stay there? Why did he have to quit?
Well, someone should ask that question, but I don't think anyone will.
And I'd like her to answer whether or not in the Warren administration, her vice president's son will become a foreign lobbyist, if that would be permitted, because she hasn't answered it.
I guarantee you, no one is going to ask that question either.
Okay. Can you stay on the... Howie Klein is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC, and everybody should go to Down with Tyranny. You will have a theme song next week, sir. Can you stay on the line for one quick second?
Sure.
Okay.
You're listening to The David Feldman Show, you happy, self-actualized hump.
Queen Elizabeth spoke before Parliament and set out ambitious policies involving the environment, health, crime, and, of course, Brexit. Let's go to London, where Jacob Le Carré Weinstein is standing by. He is our man in Great Britain. Hello there, sir.
Hello. Pleasure to talk to you.
Jacob Sager Weinstein is an American author, humorist, comedy writer, screenwriter. He's won a Writers Guild of America award, written for HBO, The Dennis Miller Show, The Onion, McSweeney's, The New Republic. And he's got three books that you should buy. You got so many here. Lyric McCarrigan, Secret Librarian, just came out. Everybody should buy that. Then he's got a series of children's books, Hyacinth and the Stone Thief, Hyacinth and the Secrets Beneath. And my favorite, How Not to Kill Your Baby. But there have been other books, The Government Manual for New Pirates, The Government Manual for New Wizards, and The Government Manual for New Superheroes. You are prolific.
Thank you. And I think what I hope your listeners will take away from those titles is that I am a serious intellectual whose opinions on the great issues of the day should be respected.
Okay.
By the way, one thing that I think is important to say, you describe me as an American author. I want to emphasize I am an Anglo-American author. I have taken an oath of loyalty to Her Majesty the Queen. I am a joint British citizen. I live here. So any mockery I do of the crown is that of a loyal subject.
Okay. Well, Monday, the Queen, accompanied by the Prince of Wales, went before Parliament and she delivered a speech and outlined about 26 bills. Who writes her speech? But first, let's talk about the event. It happened earlier yesterday. What was it like?
It was full of pageantry, as it always is. Mm-hmm. It begins with Black Rod summoning the House of Commons to attend the House of Lords by order of the Queen. She enters wearing what I would describe as probably the world's most expensive body size doily, and pulling what I believe is an extremely valuable rug, also known as the Queen's train. She sits on a ceremonial throne. She is given her speech in, and I'm not making this up, I think it is actually called the ceremonial purse, which is like this big cloth bag that's handed to her, and then she reads out the speech.
And it's not a Halloween costume. It's an actual speech, and it's an actual gown, and the jewels are all real, right?
They are, although it would be a really great prank if, like, when they hand her that sort of ancient ceremonial purse and she reaches in and then, like, instead of the speech, she pulls out a bunch of Snickers bars, you know, like, pulls off the rubber Queen Max mask and it's just like a local 8-year-old. Uh-huh. That would revolutionize the monarchy. I would totally support that.
Okay. What did she talk about during the speech?
The first thing, and it's important to note that the way she frames this, the way the speech is framed, the Queen says, "My government will be doing this." So she is sort of presenting it as though this is her will, and this is what she's ordering the government to do. But obviously it is written by the government, by Boris Johnson and his administration. So the very first thing she said was a commitment to leaving the European Union by the end of this month.
A commitment to leaving the European Union, Brexit. She is committed to Brexit.
Exactly. And because Parliament has passed a law basically saying that if Boris Johnson does not have a deal, we cannot legally exit the European Union at the end of this month, the speech she has been ordered to read by the government begins with a lie, which I think is an ancient and ceremonial thing as well, of course, that the Queen, one of her primary jobs is to lie elegantly to the country on behalf of the government.
Read the script. It's an acting job. It's a script written by the showrunner, and she has to read it as is.
That is beautifully put. And I think what we all want to believe is that this is going to be The Wire, where every season is carefully scripted from beginning to the end. I think it's actually Lost in many ways.
It's the show Lost.
Exactly, yes.
Okay, where are we with Brexit? So the Queen reconvenes Parliament, is that what it's called?
She, I suppose, is beginning a new session of Parliament. And part of what's weird about this is that traditionally the Queen's speech is given towards the beginning of a session, and it sets out what the government realistically hopes to accomplish over the next several months to a year. Pretty much everybody knows that Parliament is heading towards the end of a session. As soon as we've secured either Brexit or an extension to Brexit, it seems pretty clear there'll be a vote of no confidence, there'll be a new election. So everything that the Queen is proposing or the government is proposing through her, there's not going to be any time to actually vote on this.
Which means what? Which means in terms of Brexit, what does it mean?
So I got distracted. The beauty and pageantry of the Queen's speech called me back to that subject, but I'll rip myself away and talk about Brexit. Did I mention how good that doily looked? Oh, so beautiful.
What color was the doily?
I would describe it as an ivory cream white. And I would describe it that way basically because I'm horrible with colors and I don't really know what ivory or cream are. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if that's even a possible thing. But but Brexit, sorry.
No, ivory cream white. And were there any accents to it?
Yes, there was some ornate twirling details to it. There is what we call pointillage, and by we I mean people who don't know anything about clothes and have to make up terminology on the spot.
Mm-hmm.
It was covered with pointillage.
Pointillage, almost like a Surratt-like generosity of jewelry texture.
About dots.
Dots?
Texture, yes, but I think Surratt-like is the perfect definition description, not only for her dress, but for the speech, because when you look at it closely, it totally disappears.
Okay. And do we know what jewels she was wearing? Was it mostly diamonds, rubies? What kind of gemstones was she favoring?
I'm guessing it was the crown jewels. That's mm-hmm. generally what she wears. Mm-hmm. And every year I hold out hope that the ceremony opening of Parliament, the Queen's speech will have to be delayed because a ragtag group of lovable criminals pulled an elaborate heist to steal the crown jewels. But for some reason, that never actually takes place. But there's always next year.
And the crown?
Yes.
She was
wearing the crown.
Yeah.
Which I mean, the Netflix series. There's the sponsorship these days is incredible.
The product placement. It's disgusting.
Yes. Yeah.
Do we know what jewels dominated the crown? Was it mostly diamonds?
Yes, she was wearing what we call the Hessian cross, and by we I mean people who know nothing about crown jewels and have
she
to
was
wear- up on-
she went with the Hessian cross, very Teutonic of her.
She had a crown, and then one of the royal pages had what I think is the crown on mm-hmm. a pillow, mm-hmm. presumably because the queen is 93 and can't actually like keep the official crown jewels on her head, but I am again, making all this up based on vague surmise and guesses, which does seem appropriate for any discussion of Brexit.
Hang on for one second. I think putting the crown on a pillow was a metaphor for the speech. I think she was sleepwalking through a speech written by Boris Johnson.
Well, it's interesting. If you watch the actual speech where the Queen says, you know, this is what my government is going to do. We are going to leave the EU. We are going to end free movement. We are going to take a hard line on criminals from foreign countries. To me, when I've seen previous speech, like her Christmas address, which is usually sort of goodwill, she mm-hmm. says very sincerely and cheerfully, she says, you know, this Christmas, let's think about the people who served our country and who need our help. Whereas the Queen's speech, if you watch it, she was saying, my government will exit the EU. We will make sure. And maybe I'm projecting my own views on this, but that was how I heard it.
I think that the reason she sounded that way is because Lionel Logue put some marbles in her mouth so she wouldn't stutter.
that certainly
the Queen's speech.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I under, it could be.
It could be. So she has no say whatsoever.
She has absolutely no say. There are certain things she's done. She can sort of through choice of on ordinary state occasions, she can signify through choice of jewelry or a hat that she has some sort of disagreement with whatever state official she's appearing with.
Wearing the keychain on the left side of her jeans, that means
yes.
She's pro-Brexit. If she's wearing the keychain on the right side of her jeans, she's pinging opposite, right?
Yes, there's a long tradition from when the Queen of England was a sort of a underground subculture who could not express her opinion. There's this whole code. That's exactly right.
What color were her gloves?
They were a delicate cheval. Cheval is a color that people... Could we talk about Brexit?
Well, we are talking about it. But...
Well, I mean, it is. I guess in a sense, to what this all comes to is that this whole... It's fascinating to watch this whole elaborate ancient charade that is dressing up this very... banal and dishonest political speech.
It's a slow motion lorry wreck.
Ah, well, thank you for speaking my language. I knew what you meant. As a British person, that made sense to me.
What?
Or as we call it, a rubbish bin fire.
Does the majority, what do most people in Great Britain want? Do they want to stay or go?
So the polls, pretty much no poll for the past year, I think, has shown a majority for Brexit. There was this slight 52% majority for Brexit when the referendum took place. Since then, as the scale of the disaster has become clear, and frankly, as many of the older generation that voted for Brexit have Brexited the earth, the opinion has shifted, and there is now a slight majority for Remain. Now, if there were a second referendum, who knows what would happen? I'm sure we'd all, you know, everyone would take equal weight to the various arguments, the arguments by British people for Remain, the argument for Russian bots to leave, and who knows what would actually happen. But right now, at least, there's a slight majority for Remain.
Okay, give me worst case scenario between now and October 31st. What's the worst that can happen?
Okay, so the worst that can happen is that Boris Johnson figures out some way to get around what's called the Benn Act, which is the law that requires him to extend our exit date from the EU if we don't have a deal. So he figures out some way to get around that. We exit with no deal. And suddenly the British economy, which has been premised around the idea of this trading relationship with our largest trading partner, which is the entire European Union, collapses. Medicines can't get through. There are riots. There are food shortages. That is the worst case scenario.
And this is a completely man-made crisis then. This would be on the head of Boris Johnson.
Yes, there'd be. I suppose it would be on his head. There's a lot of heads that it goes on. That crown of Brexit shame is being passed around on the pillow of mass culpability.
Okay, and I always assumed that.
By the way, that was the brilliant metaphor of a man who has written such important books as How Not to Kill Your Baby. That's right. The sort of serious literary content you're getting from me.
Which also involves a pillow, I believe. How Not to Kill a Baby.
Indeed.
Boris Johnson, like Trump, we always assumed he was pushing the envelope, but didn't want to break it.
Right. And there is
when did he decide he was serious about Brexit?
Well, was he
really serious about Brexit at the beginning, or was it just a way to stir up the hornet's nest?
So he declared himself for Brexit before the referendum with an editorial. And supposedly the night before that was published, he had written an editorial arguing why he was going to support Remain and one why he was going to support Brexit. He was that he could go either way. He told David Cameron that he was going to support Brexit with full confidence that it would lose and that he would be seen as the guy who spearheaded this noble failure, who stood up for British independence and who didn't actually have to face any of the consequences of it.
Slow down for 1 second. So David Cameron was prime minister before Theresa May. This is the Conservative Party.
Yes.
So he was kind of grandstanding, trying to make a point.
Yes.
But he wasn't really for Brexit. Kind of the mythology behind Trump, which may or may not be true, that he thought, you know, I'll run for president, make a point, and then go get rich again.
Yes.
He didn't think it would catch on. So are there theories that Boris Johnson is a useful idiot, that he thought Brexit wasn't real, but some sinister forces within the British economy and government decided to latch onto it and make it happen?
I don't know. I feel like that kind of theory assumes a certain level of
competence
and foresight among the conspirators, which I'm not sure exists. I definitely think, I mean, there's clearly Russian funding. There are clearly people who will get rich from Brexit. But I think I think that just like blaming, like, you know, if you assign all the blame for Donald Trump on Donald Trump and not on the millions of people who voted for him, it, in a way, it's weirdly comforting because it lets you ignore the racism and the problems that are sort of bubbling to the surface and that this is a manifestation of. And I think similarly, I take, you know, Boris Johnson should be ashamed of himself. I he absolutely bears responsibility for his own actions. But I think there's some serious systemic issues that somebody like him and something like Brexit was allowed to happen.
What I don't understand is a lot of the people who voted for Brexit later said one of two things. I didn't think it would pass. This was kind of a protest vote.
Yeah.
If I had to do it again, I wouldn't. Or it sounded good at the time. I really didn't understand Brexit, so I voted for it. Now I'm sorry I did. If they were to hold a referendum again, wouldn't it fail?
It probably would, and that's why the pro-Brexit side is so adamantly against a referendum. The sort of currently the whole the one of the main arguments of the Brexit side is we can't let the people vote on it again because that would be anti-democratic.
You can't overturn a referendum once approved. That's how they rationalize it. I see.
Exactly. It was a non-binding referendum held under false pretenses in which the Leave side spent illegally. And that's that because therefore it's a sacred democratic artifact which cannot be questioned.
Boris Yeltsin is now the prime minister. And do you actually... why are you laughing?
You just said Boris Yeltsin is now the prime minister.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's okay. That's fine.
Let me steal your joke again. The other Russian puppet.
Yes.
Boris Johnson is now the prime minister.
Yes.
Can you get inside his head if he's on the fence but pushing for Brexit? What does he think the upside to all this is for him and Great Britain?
Okay, let me give you, I'll give you a couple of possible theories, and I'll save the one that I believe for last.
Okay.
There is the sinister forces behind him argument, is that he has backers who will make a killing in, who have shorted the market, who have shorted the pound. They will make a killing if Brexit happens and the British economy crashes. Therefore, his friends, his rich friends want him to do it. I have no doubt there are people out there who will make lots of money if Brexit happens, but I think they're smart enough that they will also make lots of money if Brexit doesn't happen, and I'm not convinced that really explains the craziness we've been seeing.
Okay, that's theory one. And who, other than shorting the market?
Yes.
I'm not sure what that means, actually, and we don't need to go into it, but I've heard of people doing those kind of things where you bet against a stock and you make money.
Yeah, shorting the market is where you wear a white ivory cream shalal. So go on, Karen, you had a question?
Okay, so what would be the sectors that would suffer? Like, who would, if you were going to short an industry in Great Britain, what would you short?
Well, you would probably short the pound, but the big reason I don't, or short just any sort of any part of the British economy, but the main reason I'm skeptical of that is that Brexit is going to be so bad for the British economy in general and for the financial services sector in particular that so many more people stand to lose fortunes over it. It's just hard for me to believe that it's that there is this sinister secret financial incentive to it.
Going down that path, and by the way, who's Donald Tusk? The head of the EU? A guy named Donald Tusk? I always thought that was a misprint when I saw. And Donald Tusk, I said, that's either a misprint or a nickname for Trump. But there's actually a Donald Tusk. Anyway, that's neither here nor there.
Yeah, so I was going to say, so Donald Tusk is president of the European Council. I believe there's also, there's also Jean-Claude Juncker. And I always get slightly confused between them.
Right.
But yes.
Tusk.
Yes.
I mean, if you need an excuse to crash the world economy,
right?
Maybe there's a, maybe, you know, going down that dark conspiratorial road, maybe they want to crash the world economy for reasons we don't understand, for reasons we don't understand. And what better way to do it than Brexit?
Yeah, that's fair enough. But I have to say that if your conspiracy theory is they want to do this for reasons we don't understand, that's the laziest conspiracy theory I've ever heard. I mean, can't you? Surely it's like they want to crash the economy because they're lizard people and they want to buy us up to send us up back to their home planet. I mean, we can do better than that.
Well, I think people sometimes benefit from a crashed economy.
No, I don't know. I do think that's true.
Okay. All right. Okay. That's theory number one. Theory number two as to what Boris is thinking.
Okay, and now we're entering what I personally consider the realm of plausibility, although it's not necessarily what I think, which is that Boris knows that we are not leaving on October 31st. But by repeatedly insisting that we will, when Parliament forces him to seek an extension, he can then run against Parliament. He can say, I was leading us out on October 31st. This do nothing, surrender Parliament, which are words he's used, stopped us. And he will then run, even though the Prime Minister serves with the confidence of Parliament. This is a parliamentary system. The Prime Minister is essentially the highest representative of Parliament, is the executive appointed by Parliament. He will then run against Parliament and make that sort of, he will run on the sort of populist, angry campaign.
And do you have a Labour Party that opposes Brexit?
I don't know. I know we have a Labour Party. I know they've made many statements on Brexit. I'm still not exactly sure what Labour's position is. Labour is definitely opposed to the Tory Brexit, and many members of Labour are opposed to Brexit. To be fair, the official position of Labour, which I give them credit for, is that they want a second referendum. It's not clear whether in that referendum which side they would argue for, but they do want the second referendum.
Jeremy Corbyn is the putative head of Labour.
Yes.
And there are no other real parties that would enter, right?
Well, that is wrong. There's a number of parties. It's really hard to know what the results will be.
But like right Farage, now, is Farage still part of it?
Yeah, so Farage is head of the Brexit Party, and this, by the way, is part of the explanation for why Johnson is so hardcore for Brexit. That right now, if the Tories lose votes, they are likely to lose them to the Brexit Party. So there's this incentive to sort of turn to the right to try to win those voters back. Although I think in the process they lose more centre.
But he could form a coalition with Farage, couldn't he? If he has to make a government,
he would, but then the Brexit Party would have to get more members in Parliament. They simply do not have the numbers. I don't think there's any members of the Brexit Party right now in Parliament. So they'd have to have an overwhelming victory to form enough to have a coalition. So,
and the Lib, wasn't there something like the Lib Dems at one time?
Exactly. So when you said there's no third party, this is why I argued. So right now there's Conservatives, Labour's, there's the Liberal Democrats who are not even the third biggest party in Parliament currently. It's Conservative, Labour. There's the Scottish National Party, which has 35 members. Currently, the Lib Dems have 17 members of Parliament. But if there is another election, there is a good chance that sort of centrist Labour voters will vote Lib Dem, and centrist Conservative voters will vote Lib Dems. And the Lib Dems could do pretty well. I don't think they could get a majority. I think it will still be more Labour than Lib Dems. But there could be enough Lib Dems, which obviously Liberal Democrats is what that's short for, there could be enough Lib Dems to form a coalition with Labour.
It feels like, I mean, I don't know anything about this. We say that there's really no difference between Nancy Pelosi and Donald Trump when we're complaining about Washington, D.C. If on the issue of the day, Brexit, neither party is against it officially, it's a political problem more than anything else, isn't it?
Well, it is definitely this huge, crazy political problem.
I mean, how can you not have a party? How can you not have a party that is officially against Brexit at this point?
Well, that this is why the Lib Dems have been doing so well, that in all so in the U.S., obviously, you have the presidential election every 4 years, you have a House and senatorial election every 2 years, or some Senate seats every 2 years. I know that the Senate is 6 years, but every 2 years, some Senate seats are going to be up. And during those elections, you often view those as bellwethers for the next big presidential election. Mm-hmm. Similarly, if you have local elections, or gubernatorial elections, you'll view those as bellwethers. So there's something similar here in the UK, where you have council elections, you have by-elections if somebody steps down, and you have an election to replace them. In all of those elections, the Lib Dems have been taking votes away from both Labour and the Tories. For exactly the reason you say, that people want that there has to be some party opposed to Brexit, and right. The Lib Dems are vehemently opposed to it. So Lib Dem, the Greens, the Scottish National Party, they are all vehemently against Brexit. And they've been doing, depending on which poll you look, depending on which election, they've all been doing much better or somewhat better or as well as the Conservative and Labour relative. They say the swing, which is sort of how many votes are shifting one way or another. And the mm-hmm. swing has been to those parties with a clearly defined position. There's also been a swing towards the Brexit Party, because the Brexit Party, it's right there in the name. You know what it stands for. You know it's
right.
pro-Brexit.
Right, right. So what do you think happens? What's the third?
So the third explanation is that Boris Johnson doesn't really know what he's doing, and he's just trying to win the day. He's trying to win the headlines today. He's trying to get his opinion polls to go up today, and there is no long-term plan, and he's just sort of bumbling through. And I think it's the George W. Bush or the Donald Trump effect, where all his life he's been rich and privileged, and whatever he's done to get through the day has been good enough, and he's never had to suffer the long-term consequences of a failure to plan in the long term. And it's worked for him all his life, so why shouldn't it keep working?
But he's not as big a fool as Donald Trump. I mean, he's a writer, a thinker. I'm not saying he's not an idiot, but he's not a fool.
No, I do think he's smarter. I don't think he's senile. I don't think he probably doesn't have narcissistic personality disorder, or if it does, it's less severe than Trump's. I do think he has a functioning brain, and I keep hoping that he's capable of his enlightened political self-interest and that will act as something of a check on him. But I don't know. I'm not convinced. I'm becoming less convinced of that every day.
And the Queen, what happens to her credibility after reading a speech like that? She can't be for Brexit.
Well, I didn't see which side of her head the crown jewels were tilted to, so I don't know. But the particular thing that the Queen reputedly has been unhappy about was, as I think we discussed last time we spoke, she suspended Parliament. And obviously, Boris Johnson ordered her to. She suspended it. She prorogued it for 5 weeks. And the court ruled that was illegal, mm-hmm. Or unlawful, I'm sorry. And therefore, Parliament was back in session. So in practice, I suppose, no harm, no foul. The courts undid it. It's now undone. But what that means is that the Prime Minister advised the Queen to do something against the law, which is awkward and unfortunate. I've been trying to the whole time I've lived in the UK now for 17 years, I've been trying to understand the monarchy. And I think I finally found my answer in an old Onion article, I think from like 2000, which is, and I'm paraphrasing, so I'm not doing the headline the full justice, but it's something like all of family's neuroses projected onto dog. And so it's like the kid says, mommy, Fido is lonely. No one's, yes, you get it. So,
okay.
So that's like the kid says, mommy, Fido's lonely. No one's playing with him. And the mother says, Fido just wants to be left alone for 5 minutes. Is that too much to ask? This is the role of the monarchy in modern Britain, that whatever you think about Brexit, you say, so you heard me earlier saying, boy, that poor Queen, she's really against Brexit, but she had to sit through this awful speech that Boris Johnson foisted on her. And mm-hmm. I'm sure there are people out there saying you could see the glint in the Queen's eyes when she promised British independence from the European Union. So that is her job. She's just there for us to project whatever we believe onto her.
It exposes the lie of a constitutional monarchy.
Yes. Yeah. It is a lie, but it's almost a jointly agreed upon pretense. There are certainly people out there who believe devoutly in sort of the power and majesty of the Queen, but I do think there's a lot of people out there who know it's sort of silly and made up, but agree to try to keep things civil, that will just project this on the Queen, and that will allow us to sort of keep calm or repress our intense passions about this.
Right. Walter Bagehot, I think I'm pronouncing that properly, divided the Queen from Parliament. I believe he said the Parliament is the efficient, and I don't know what the Queen is supposed to be, but the Queen doesn't get involved with the efficient, the running of the government. But it doesn't look efficient, does it?
No. And I do think that things like this, by the way, the thing about the Queen's speech is traditionally the Queen's speech has a specific point, which is for the government to announce its policies. For the government to get ready, you suspend Parliament for like 2 or 3 days before the speech. So honestly, the real reason we had this Queen's speech is that Boris Johnson wanted a pretense to suspend Parliament for 5 weeks. He said, oh, we're having a Queen's speech, we're suspending Parliament. That suspension was ruled illegal, but he kind of couldn't back down and admit that the whole Queen's speech thing was just a pretense. Mm-hmm. So we had to go through that. So it's a pretense on top of a pretense, possibly on top of a pretense, but I've lost track of how many pretenses we're deep in.
And we don't want to be pretentious.
No, indeed.
I looked it up. Walter Bagehot, I know I'm not pronouncing that properly, divided it between the dignified and the efficient. So the House of Commons would be one of the efficient institutions running the country, while the Queen or the King would be the dignified, and never the two should meet.
Yes, that sounds about right. Well, certainly we've been doing an excellent job of keeping the dignified separate from Parliament. I don't know about the efficient, but we've definitely kept the dignified far away.
Well, how much is your heart skipping a beat? How terrified are you of all this? Because right here in America, when, you know, I watch Michael Brooks, he has a show on YouTube, and he's talking about Lula in Brazil and Syria, and we try to follow what's going on around the world, but, you know, we're Americans. If it's not happening to us, we don't care. I can't get a handle on how frightened the people of Great Britain are, other than the craziness. I know this is crazy, but is there fear?
Well, I think at this point we've sort of gotten used to it. I think the question of how afraid we should be maybe comes back to that question you asked earlier of what's Boris Johnson up to. Mm-hmm. If you believe that there's some sort of secret genius going on, then we should be terrified, because that means he has some secret plan to get around this act that requires him to put off leaving the EU, that's supposed to stop us from leaving without a deal. If you believe my theory that he's just sort of bumbling along and trying to get through the day, then his repeated promises that we're leaving on the 31st are just meaningless noise, and the law that's meant to prevent that will prevent that. I just don't know at this point.
A good time?
No. I hope not.
Right.
I mean, he's looked tired and unhappy. It very much to my eyes has been that expression of the dog who finally caught the car he's been chasing and doesn't know what to do with it.
Mm-hmm.
But you know, maybe I'm projecting on him as well.
Yeah. Very reminiscent of World War I.
Yeah. Yeah. It's true that
have people compared it to World War I?
Surprisingly, I have not heard those comparisons. But you're absolutely right. That's like the trains are on the way. We have to go to war because we've already sent the troops off on the trains.
Right. Now let's compare it to the Crimean War. Can you do that? Or the Peloponnesian?
Half a league Brexit, all in the Valley of Death. And that's about as much as I remember from high school.
Wow. That's amazing. And what are your thoughts before you go? And thank you for this.
Stormed at with shot and shell, boldly they rode it well. All in the Valley of Death rode the 600. Sorry, just in case my sixth grade English teacher is listening, I wanted to get that in.
Yes. Okay. I'm intimidated now. By your sixth grade education, by the way. I'm just intimidated by what you learned in sixth grade. So when you look at what's going on in the United States, are you guys paying attention to Trump, or you're thinking we got our own problems?
There has definitely been some attention, especially with the whole leaving the Kurds out to dry. Because
right. How big a story is that?
It's been something of a story. I do think that Brexit has been dominating the headlines, but just because Britain still has this complex feeling about its own role in Iraq and the Middle East, I think that has caught people's attention.
Yeah, yeah. Great job, sir. Jacob Sager Weinstein is a Writers Guild award-winning comedy writer. He's written for some of your favorite shows, including Dennis Miller Live, The Onion, McSweeney's, North American Review, The New Republic. He also has written too many books for me to mention on this show, but his most recent is Lyric McKerrigan, Secret Librarian, and he's got a series of children's books, Hyacinth and the Stone Thief, Hyacinth and the Secrets Beneath, and my favorite, How Not to Kill Your Baby. How do people follow you on Twitter, sir?
I am Jacob SW. That's S for Sager, W for Weinstein on Twitter. And or you can just do what I do, which is forget and then Google Jacob Sager Weinstein and hope that Google gets it for you.
Thank you, sir. Stand in line for 1 second. Steve Skrovan, co-hosts the Ralph Nader Radio Hour, heard nationwide on Pacifica, and as a podcast. Hello there, Steve.
Hello, David. I hope you have a lot of listeners in L.A.
Yes, I do. And I understand you have a big stand-up for Main Street event coming up. Is it Saturday or Sunday?
It's Sunday. Early evening. It's the ninth year we've been doing this. Stand Up for Main Street Night. You were involved in the first couple when you were still out here in L.A. But, yeah, we've been doing it for 9 years, and it's this Sunday, October 20th.
When you say Stand Up for Main Street, you're raising money for Public Citizen. What is Public Citizen?
Public Citizen is this legendary nonpartisan public interest group that was started by Ralph and a few other people back in 1971. And it is responsible for so many good things that have happened in the country in the last 48 years, in contrast to all the bad things that have been happening. And over a big wide range of issues. And right now we're battling the corporate takeover of the Trump administration.
Mm-hmm.
As bad as he is on everything else, and he should be impeached and all of that, all the stuff that he's done to these government agencies, these so-called regulatory pullbacks, it's all killing us and life on our planet, our ability to live on the planet, among other things, and the health and safety of people too. So
you've described Public Citizen as the people's lobbyist.
Yes, yes. And that's kind of become a catchphrase for them. You know, corporations have lobbyists. People need advocates, too. We do some lobbying. We have a group called Congress Watch. That's the kind of the lobbying arm of the group. But, you know, technically, we're advocating on all different fronts in the halls of Congress. Yeah.
For example,
we were the first ones to sue Trump over that bogus emergency order that he was, you know, using to justify the funding of his racist border wall.
Mm-hmm.
And we have this, it's another part of Public Citizen, a crack litigation group that is really kind of the litigation group for a lot of the other public interest groups too. They kind of turn to us because we've tried over 60 cases in the Supreme Court. No other public interest group has that kind of standing, has that kind of reputation. We also won passage by a 234 to 193 margin in the House of Representatives this bill called H.R. 1. It's called For the People Act, and it's the most sweeping pro-democracy and anti-corruption legislation of the past 50 years. Every Senate Democrat supports the legislation, and it includes all these measures on campaign finance reform, voting rights, ethics reform, gerrymandering. It's kind of your one-stop shopping to really clean up the swamp.
This is H.R. 1. It was
H.R. 1,
on Nancy Pelosi's first day as Speaker.
Yeah, and we were behind that. We went a long way toward writing that, because that's what people don't understand about how Washington works is the politicians themselves usually don't write the legislation. A lot of times they don't even read it, what they vote on. It's provided by people, you know, like public, you know, groups like Public Citizen. It can be provided on the other side by groups like the Heritage Foundation
or ALEC. And,
or ALEC. Yes. ALEC especially works on the state level and on the local level. But we work on the national level, and we kind of give them, you know, hey, this is something you should support. And we did a lot in coalition with others to help write this ledger. This legislation, if I can even pronounce that word.
Now, Public Citizen was set up in 71, around the same time as the Powell memo. So the Powell memo was specifically targeting Ralph Nader.
Yeah.
And they said, we need to start building think tanks to counteract Ralph Nader. So they created American Enterprise and the Heritage Foundation.
And all sorts of Cato and, you know, all sorts of think tanks that was kind of – they were in the Powell Memorandum, which you're referring to, which was written by Lewis Powell, who at that time was the general counsel for the Chamber of Commerce, which is the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, which is the kind of the Death Star in Star Wars terms for Public Citizen. Public Citizen were kind of the rebel forces, and the U.S. Chamber of Commerce is kind of the Death Star, because it is not like your local Chamber of Commerce, which can do a lot of good things locally for businesses. This is the national one that really is just looking out for the mega corporate interests. And he was general counsel that Lewis Powell later became Supreme Court Justice, appointed by Richard Nixon, and he'd written this memorandum which sort of outlined, hey, we've got to, you know, the late 60s, early 70s is, you know, there's just too much reform going on. We got to get a hold of this and rein it in. And he did name check Ralph Nader, plus a number of other activists who have at that time were incredibly popular and appealing to young people. And that's, you're absolutely right. That's when all that conservative think tank started. And the difference between Public Citizen and these conservative think tanks is, you know, the Heritage Foundation is funded by incredibly wealthy corporate interests, and they can take corporate money. Public Citizen does not do that. And this is why we need to do these benefits, like Stand Up for Main Street, that because we represent people, and they, you know, the old saw is, if you want to know what a politician stands for, find out who's paying them. That's the same thing with public interest groups. Who's paying that interest group? That's who they're going to answer to. And Public Citizen answers to nobody but ordinary people like you and me.
Nobody but ordinary people like you and me. Steve Skrovan, along with Henriette Mantel, directed An Unreasonable Man. I recommend that everybody see this monumentally beautiful and insightful documentary about the life of Ralph Nader. And because you directed this great movie, you ended up sitting on the board of Public Citizen. It was founded, you say, in 1971. Where did the seed money come from?
Well, it came from Ralph. He sued General Motors, because back in 1966, 65, he had written this book called Unsafe at Any Speed, and General Motors tried to smear him. I mean, we're familiar with smear campaigns all the time. You can see Donald Trump wants to get this whistleblower revealed so he can smear the whistleblower. Mm-hmm. Well, General Motors was the largest corporation in the world at the time, and they got wind of this book coming out, which was very critical of the auto industry. and in particular, the Corvair, a couple of models of the Corvair, which were very dangerous. And a lot of people don't know because they haven't actually read Unsafe at Any Speed. The Corvair was just one chapter in this book. It was really far reaching in a lot of ways, talking about pollution standards and things like that. Nobody was talking about seat back in 1965. Seat belts and airbags, exactly. And it revealed that they had all the safety features. They knew these safety features were around since the mid-50s, but they they buried them because they thought they would be too costly and safety doesn't sell. Now you can't see a commercial on television for a car that isn't selling safety. But back then, they tried to smear him, and
they knew, but they knew that the Corvair was tipping over on turns. But they did a cost-benefit analysis, and they said, you know, it's cheaper to pay out settlements to the people who die or are injured than it is to fix the assembly line and fix the problem.
Yeah, it's kind of the same thing we're talking about on the radio hour all the time about the Boeing MAX 8. Mm-hmm. It's that kind of cost benefit analysis, and turns out people can get killed, and that's the cost of doing business.
Right.
But as a result of this smear campaign, where the actual head of General Motors was called in front of Congress and publicly apologized to Ralph, sued for invasion of privacy and won. Back then, in those dollars, it was, I think, $475,000 settlement, which in today's dollars.
They were sending women to him. They were trying to create compromising situations and photograph them so that they could dump a file on his desk and say, it stops now. We call it compromat now.
Exactly. Exactly. It's what Trump is trying to get on Joe Biden in Ukraine. Mm-hmm. And so it's, you know, that it's the same playbook. But Ralph, they couldn't get anything on him. And he rejected all the hookers who were in the grocery store trying to track him down. Mm-hmm. And he won all of that money, and that became the seed money. So ironically, General Motors is the entity to thank for providing the seed money that created Public Citizen, which now 48 years in has done so much to counter corporate power in the world and in the country in particular. So
if it weren't Public for Ralph Nader and Public Citizen, there'd be no seatbelts, there'd be no airbags. And then you can extend from that the Clean Water Act, the EPA, OSHA.
Yeah.
It all comes from Ralph Nader.
Yeah. And ironically, now Ralph has not been connected with the organization for the last 38 years. What he does is he creates these nonprofits, these organizations, these public interest groups, and then steps away from them as soon as they can run on their own so that they are not subject to the vagaries of his popularity. Mm-hmm. So Ralph stepped down in 1980, and it was run for 27 years. The president was Joan Claybrook, who is also a tremendous auto safety expert and advocate. And for the past coming on 10 years now, I think, it's been run by Rob Weissman, who we've had on our show, and is a guy who, before he was president of Public Citizen, is one of the people who used intellectual property laws to reduce the price of AIDS drugs in Africa. And so he, along with another guy named Jamie Love, are responsible for saving
millions of lives. And he was a kid at the time.
Millions of lives. Wasn't he a kid? Yeah, just out of Harvard. Yeah.
One of the few good Harvard people.
Yeah, that's right.
There aren't many.
No.
I think Ralph and Rob Weissman.
Well, Ralph is a Princeton guy.
But he graduated from Harvard Law.
Yeah, it's true. Rob, you know, there are good. Lori Wallach, another one who does all the trade stuff for Public Citizen. She was part of the class in Harvard Law School of Barack Obama and his buddy Michael Froman, who became his trade representative. And it was why Michael Frum is the reason Barack Obama was so bad on free trade. And Lori Wallach, who was at Harvard Law at the same time, was not not doing the law review stuff. She was actually working in legal aid. So it kind of their professional careers paralleled their interest in their graduate school years, too.
So you need to support Public Citizen. Go buy a ticket. How do you buy a ticket to see?
Go to citizen.org.
And who is on the bill? What comedians are on the bill?
On the bill, we've got a great bill. And I'll just reiterate, it's Sunday, October 20th. It's this coming Sunday for you people in Los Angeles at the WJ Theater in Beverly Hills, which is 135 South Doheny, just off of Wilshire. The show goes from 6:30 to about 8:30. So we know it's a school night, so it's easy in, easy. You don't have to get dressed up. There's no rubber chicken. It's in a theater. And we booked the great Larry Miller.
Wow.
From 10 Things I Hate About You and all the Christopher Guest movies. And our mutual friend, John Fugelsang, is coming in from New York.
Wow.
He's doing the show. Yeah, Fugelsang's doing the show. I know you've done his daily Sirius XM radio show, mm-hmm. Tell Me Everything, all the time. We also have Cristela Alonso from the Cristela Alonso Show. She's coming in. My old friend Rondell Sheridan, who for you younger people who know, he's from That's So Raven and Even Stevens on the Disney Channel. He'll be there along with Amy Anderson, who's in Modern Family, and a young comic named Matt Kirshen, who's been on Last Comic Standing.
Yeah, he's been on this show. And will Lou Schneider be in the audience?
Lou Schneider will not be in the audience because he will be on stage emceeing. I'll be hosting.
Lou Schneider?
Yes.
The Lou Schneider.
The Lou Schneider from Everybody Loves Raymond and the Goldbergs as a writer and director will be. Actually, he did an episode of Everybody Loves Raymond, too. He played a photographer in one episode.
He will be emceeing. He had an HBO special.
He did back in the day. He was a stand-up. So we all come from a stand-up background. So it's a fun show of laughter.
I did a stand-up for Main Street one year and did my entire act about Lou Schneider.
You did. And
didn't go well.
Lou Schneider's wife enjoyed it very much, but I'm not sure anybody else knew what the hell you were talking about.
Yeah, including me. And if people want to donate to...
Go to citizen.org. Yeah, if you can't come, you can always donate. Go to citizen.org. Click on there's a icon there, a button for Stand Up for Main Street, and you can donate whatever you want, and you can RSVP and buy tickets. It's you should get them soon because we're selling out, and
the show is selling out, but Public Citizen never will.
That's a great. I love that. I think we're going to use that.
All right, I want money.
The show is selling up, but Public Citizen will never will.
You have to pay me for that. I have to make money off. I'm joking about that. You don't even joke about that.
No,
it's sacred. It really is sacred.
So let me just reiterate, Dave, because you've been so nice to have me on. Sunday, October 20th, it's coming up. There's a reception at 5 p.m. in the lobby at the WJ Theater in Beverly Hills, 135 South Doheny. The show starts at 6:30. We got Larry Miller, John Fugelsang, Rondell Sheridan, Cristela Alonso, Amy Anderson, and Matt Kirshen. Lou Schneider and I will be hosting. And here's something we've discussed on the Radio Hour just recently, how important it is for people to get out from behind their screens into face-to-face contact with each other. And this is a great, fun way to do that. So come to the WGA Theater this Sunday, October 20th.
Absolutely. Who's on the Ralph Nader Radio Hour this week?
Coming up, we're going to have Rashida Tlaib.
Congresswoman
Rashida Tlaib, representative from Michigan, who is one of the squad, along with AOC, Ayanna Pressley, and Ilhan Omar, who have been singled out for abuse by this jackass in the White House. And we talk about her being denied the ability to go to Palestine to visit her grandmother by the Netanyahu government. And we talk a lot about impeachment with her. Mm-hmm. She's famously said, impeach the MF-er.
Mm-hmm. I don't think his mother would want him. Who else is on the show?
Well, we have the great David Feldman.
Never heard of him.
He'll be on the show. And no, she's our only guest. It's Rashida Tlaib, and then we do a lot of listener questions.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah. I didn't know how you edited. You and I talked to Ralph.
Fantastic.
We get to ask him questions like the old days.
Comedy writer Steve Skrovan directed An Unreasonable Man with Henriette Mantel. It's a great documentary that people should pick up and watch. It's about Ralph Nader. And he is also on the board of Public Citizen. They're doing an important benefit at the Writers Guild Theater in California, Los Angeles, this Sunday. If you can't make it, go to citizen.org.
Yep, go to citizen.org, click on Stand Up for Main Street. There's a donate button and an RSVP button. So if you can make it, click the RSVP button. If you can't make it and you still want to give a little something to support, it's really not a benefit for Public citizens. It's a benefit for us because Public Citizen works for us.
Right.
So benefit yourself and
go benefit
maybe
yourself.
That's right. Go benefit yourself. Maybe that's a T-shirt we should put out there.
Go benefit
by clicking on the donate button and you know, and give what you can, because it's, you know, like Bernie's campaign, it's ordinary people who keep us afloat and working.
Right. Right. So you've been plugging this event every year on my show for the past 9 years.
Yes.
What did I do finally? What did I achieve finally after 9 years? What didn't I call Public Citizen?
I don't even want to say it, because then it'll give people, it'll then make the confusion again, because we are against what you're saying.
Every interview, and I did it with Rob Weissman when he used to do the show. I think he stopped. Rob runs Public Citizen.
Yeah.
I think he got sick of doing my show because I kept referring to it as Citizens United.
Oh, there you did. Mm-hmm. Those are the bad guys, Citizens United.
Right.
They are the ones who, this is why we have a problem with money in politics. And two of our big pushes have been getting money out of politics. The Democracy is for People campaign that we do, which is to overturn Citizens United, which if Hillary Clinton had been elected, we probably would have been able to do. Mm-hmm. But now we've got to delay that for 4 years. And in the interim, we have used some funding that we actually got from the Stand Up for Main Street show to make Medicare for All the main campaign that we're doing. So, I mean, we do a lot of stuff and we can do a lot of stuff simultaneously. But right now, Medicare for All is the coalition that we're spearheading.
Fantastic. And I think you underestimate at your own peril the power of Medicare for All politically, not you. But if there's a candidate out there who is talking about outlawing the insurance companies and pushing Medicare for All, he or she could win.
Yeah. And I don't think you'd even have to talk about outlawing the insurance companies. You just have Medicare for All and they will die a natural death.
They will die the same way they kill the... Okay. Steve yes. Skrovan, stand on the line for 1 second, sir.
All right.
Great job. Scott Rogowsky joins us. You might remember him as Quiz Daddy from HQ Trivia. You can now watch him co-hosting Change Up, a baseball program broadcast on the subscription video streaming network. What is it, DAZN? What is it?
DAZN, they call it.
DAZN.
But that's good. I'm impressed that you got all that other stuff in about subscription, streaming service. A lot of people don't even know. They think I work at a frozen yogurt shop. DAZN. But no, DAZN, yes. It's a streaming service, boxing, MMA, and baseball. And I host a Change Up with Adnan Virk. It's the baseball show, and it's a fun show, and we have one more show this postseason, October 22nd, and then we're off till March, next opening day.
You don't go down to spring training?
Maybe. We haven't talked about our spring plans yet, but for now, it's really just a whip-around live show that exists when the games are on, so that's the crux of the Change-Up show. I might be doing other programming in the off-season that would be ancillary to the main event. so to speak. But
and tell me,
the main event, David Feldman.
What is happening in baseball this week? What are the big stories involving?
Big stories. The Houston Astros just tied up the ALCS with the Yankees, who had a 1-0 lead on the series, but Houston won last night, so it's tied up 1-1. The Nats are really surprising the baseball world on the National League side. You know, these are the league championship series. So the winners of these series.
Hello?
Which maybe you've heard of.
You say it again. Yeah, you broke up. We're in noise. There's somebody outside my window who is reenacting the wood chipping scene from Fargo, and you're in your car.
I'm in the car on the Pulaski Skyway, beautiful Elizabeth, New Jersey. I'm seeing it stretch out beyond me, Newark in the distance.
Where are you going?
Port of Newark.
Where are you going?
I'm heading down to Philadelphia with my girlfriend. She's lecturing at the University of Pennsylvania, Allison Zuckerman, famed artist.
Wow.
Yes, at Allison Zuckerman on Instagram. You should give her a follow. She's definitely worth it.
And
more, she's got more going on than I do.
And she shows her paintings.
You should be talking to her. Yeah, she has paintings hanging in museum galleries around the world. She just got back from Tel Aviv. She was in Israel, the Herzliya Museum. University of Florida in Gainesville. She has an opening there. University of Akron. She's going to be down in Miami for the Art Basel in December with the Rubel collection. They're opening a new museum.
Wow.
So she's got a lot going on. You should really be calling her.
Why? Well, would she give me a painting?
She's not going to give you a painting unless you give her something of equal value in return. And I'm afraid, David, I don't think you have anything of equal value.
How about I interview her on my show? And then you and I sublet her paint. Like, she gives us a painting and we sublet it. Or we cut it up into little tiny pieces where the parts mm-hmm. are more valuable than the whole. That's what I was thinking about doing with, like, a Jackson Pollock. Just cut it up.
A little swatch. Yeah, like what Topps does with Babe Ruth jerseys and baseball bats. Like, they buy these expensive jerseys and memorabilia and chop them up and put them into small patches of them into baseball cards. And they say, well, this is democratic. Everybody gets a piece of it versus, you know, one rich guy having this 100,000 jersey hanging in his closet. Everyone can have a little piece of Babe Ruth's bat or hat or whatever.
And, you mean it's pressed into a card?
It's pressed into a card. This is actually something they've been doing for like 20 years in the industry, baseball card industry.
Didn't Kiss used to do that with their blood?
I'm not kidding. And a lot of people are furious because, you know, they're destroying these artifacts, essentially.
Didn't Kiss do that? Didn't they have a comic book that had their blood in it?
Who, Kiss?
Yeah.
Dan?
Yeah.
I wouldn't put it past them.
All right.
I'm no expert on 70s glam horror rock, but baseball is more my speed. But yes, there's big baseball news this week.
Who wins the World Series? Who's winning the World Series?
Oh man, I had the Braves in the World Series against Houston. I had Houston winning, but the Braves got bounced. I still think Houston is going this thing. Although the Yankees are tough, man, and the Nats could really surprise. I mean, they've already surprised. Wild card team beating the Dodgers, now up 2-0 on the Cardinals. They have a nice pass to the World Series, and they haven't been there since 1924, I think, Washington team. So that could be a boon for Washington, D.C.'s fan base. Long-suffering.
All right. So you called me. What did you call me about?
You called me back because I guess now you have the microphones turned on. I called you yesterday just to have a conversation, friendly chat. Haven't talked in a while. The first thing out of your mouth is, when are you calling into my show? I mean, David, you know, you have a life. You realize, like, your life isn't your show. You got to pull your head out of your ass with this.
What are you talking about?
I think you're a little too deep.
What are you talking
about? You're a little too deep into the podcast.
Get lost. What are you talking about? You called me yesterday because you wanted to do the show.
I called you, and you almost had an aneurysm because you couldn't find the microphone to turn it on fast enough. You can't talk to people unless they're on your podcast, apparently. This is like a real delusion you have, a real mental illness.
What are you talking about? The phone rang. I don't answer my phone.
I'm calling to say, you know, it's La Shana Tova. We just had the new year. I want to ask what you're toning for. I wanted to ask your thoughts on Jeffrey Epstein and what do you think the first Yom Kippur without Epstein was like.
By the way, I heard something about Jeffrey Epstein.
What'd you hear?
I had heard through the grapevine that the head of Victoria's Secret, who turned over all his money to Jeffrey Epstein, I heard that he and Jeffrey at one point were an item, but they were in love with one another. This is what I've heard. And that's how that Wexner, is that his name, the head of Victoria's
Secret? Oh, that's the guy. Right. He was a owner of some big apparel company. Yeah.
And that's how Epstein got his hands on the fortune. That's what I heard.
Well, you know,
people are saying
he seemed to be willing to do just about anything to make a buck. And
and more and more people who I respect are saying that he was murdered. What do you think?
I mean, all I'm saying is the guy was in my neighborhood. He's my neighbor.
Jeffrey Epstein.
Near the Metropolitan Correctional Center.
What kind of neighbor was he? Was he quiet?
I'll tell you, he was a little disrespectful. I saw him on the street one day. I tried to give him a high five. He left me hanging. But I could see into his room from my apartment. I could see into the center, and man, I thought that guy had some swinging parties.
You live next door to the Metropolitan Correction Center?
I do. El Chapo's there too. I got quite the crew hanging out near Foley Square, downtown New York.
And they have held El Chapo, Sammy the Bull, Gravano. All of them were able to transition to another prison without getting hung. But somehow Jeffrey Epstein, they just couldn't keep him from hanging himself. It does feel a little suspicious because I do understand as time has passed, I think it's been about 2 months, apparently he videotaped everyone and everything. And when you think of Bill Barr, whose father hired Jeffrey Epstein to teach at his private school. I think it was Dalton. Bill Barr's father ran Dalton, and he hired Jeffrey Epstein. When you consider that Bill Barr, our attorney general, is meeting with Rupert Murdoch, talking about Lord knows what, and doing Donald Trump's dirty work, you know, I like to think Jeffrey Epstein killed himself. But it wouldn't surprise me if Bill Barr and the Justice Department, for the good of the country, we couldn't survive the truth. Both parties couldn't survive the truth about Jeffrey Epstein. So it's best if we go in there, get rid of him, go into the apartment, the mansion, and clean it all out. Right? For the good of the country, for the good of Queen Elizabeth and Prince Andrew, and right?
Sure, I'm with you on that, Dave. I'll accept anything you say as long as we can have a nice, normal human interaction conversation that doesn't involve your podcast.
Well, we're having a conversation right now. You called me yesterday. I don't answer my phone normally, but I saw Scott Rogowsky, the quizmaster from HQ Trivia. I will take this call because there's something in it for me. He'll do my show, so I took the call, and I would assume that the only reason you called me was you wanted back on the show. So I took the call.
I told you explicitly yesterday that I did not want to do your show. I don't ever want to do your show again.
Then why did you call me?
I wanted to call. Well, I wanted to get your take on something. I mean, I was, you know.
Wanted to do my show then?
No. I wanted to talk politics.
So you wanted to be on my show?
I want to meet Howie Klein. I just want Howie Klein's email. Can you get me that?
Wait, but hang on. Why would you call me if you didn't want
to? To use you to get Howie Klein's contact. Maybe Burt Ross as well. He seems like a fun guy. I want to talk.
Do you want to go? Are you allowed in front of your girlfriend? Are you allowed to talk about why you want to talk to Howie Klein, or would that get you into trouble?
Maybe we'll talk about that another time.
Well, why don't I ask you questions and you say yes or no so she can't hear? Okay.
I think we're going to be stopping for coffee soon, so we got to wrap this up anyway.
Are you thinking of doing something that might involve Howard Klein?
Perhaps.
And would it involve perhaps leaving show business?
Perhaps temporarily.
Would it involve a 2-year gig?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think it would.
Would it involve?
I just missed my turn, and now I'm going to be involved in getting angry at you for keeping me on the phone here. I'm trying to navigate my way through the depths of New Jersey.
Okay, I will put you in touch with Howie Klein. You're thinking of running for political office. Do you support?
I am.
Do you support Medicare for all?
Absolutely.
Do you support raising the minimum wage to $50 a minute? Are you a socialist? Are you a socialist?
I put myself towards that end of the spectrum, yeah.
Are you for a two-state solution in America?
You know, I don't
in America.
In America, yeah.
All right. Scott Rogowsky, how do people follow you on Twitter?
Follow at Allison Zuckerman on Instagram. And really, you can follow me at Scott Rogowsky on Twitter or on Instagram at Quiz Daddy's Closet. I'm thrift shopping through Jersey. That's the real reason for this trip. Yes, Allison is lecturing tonight, but the real reason for this trip is our thrifting adventures to stock up on vintage clothing that I can resell at a premium with the money going to charity.
And what's the charity?
A Team Lifeline, High Lifeline. They support families and children battling pediatric illness and cancer. And they have a camp upstate New York I visited this summer where they have an on-site pediatric oncology unit, and they have 2-to-1 counselor to camper ratio. Everyone's trained, medically trained, because these kids are actually going through chemo while they're at camp. It's an incredible thing. And we raised over $13,000 so far. I'm running in the Miami Marathon with them. Allie and I are both running in February. So we're raising our money for the marathon via my T-shirt sales.
All right, let's slow down, then I'll let you go. The name of the camp is what?
Camp Simcha.
How do you spell
upstate?
It?
S-I-M-C-H-A.
And Simcha means
joy,
happiness?
The Hebrew word for happiness, joy, right. So they bring happiness to kids who really don't have a lot of happiness in their lives when they're battling these illnesses. And the families are also the ones, you know, they're dealing 24/7 with health care for their kids.
Right.
And they have a week or 2 weeks in the summer where they can, you know, go off and have a vacation and let the camp take care of their kids. And that's a huge relief, too, because it really is such a full-time operation that they don't get any breaks. So the camp offers the family a break, and it offers the kids a chance to be normal kids and hang out and have a good, normal camp experience.
So you can donate to Camp Simcha, S-I-M-C-H-A, or you can...
Yeah, well, High Lifeline is the charity that runs Camp Simcha.
Spell it,
C-H-I-C-H-A-I, sorry, C-H-A-I, High as in life, Lifeline.
And you are selling vintage clothing marked up for charity.
Right.
And how do people...
Cool stuff. I mean, really good stuff. Vintage jerseys, hats. I mean, if you like vintage clothing, I got the best stuff. At Quiz Daddy's Closet on Instagram.
Quiz Daddy. Is there an apostrophe?
No apostrophe on Instagram. There's just Quiz Daddy's Closet.
Now, Simcha means what?
Happiness.
Okay.
Joy.
I just wrote a joke that you can have.
Okay.
I think it's a joke. Did you know that the Eskimos have 1,000 words for snow? Did you know that?
Yeah. I heard that. I also heard it's a kind of a myth, but go ahead.
And the Jews have exactly one word for happiness. That's it. One word.
That's good.
That's it.
You got
Simcha.
That's it.
Is that funny?
Well, let's leave. That's good. That's good, Dave. We'll leave
all
it
right.
at that. We'll
you voting? Are you voting for Bernie?
I'm voting for him to get out of the hospital. I think I'm going. I don't know, man. His time came, and I think he's just a little over the hill at this point. To be
so,
honest, but I do love his policies.
So
I
the quiz daddy him. Is a schmuck. Not too bright.
No,
he's going to be our next president. Schmucko.
I'm trying to be rational here.
He's going to be.
I think Lizzie's got a better chance.
Well, you don't get to meet Howie Klein now. I'm not supporting your candidacy.
Right.
When I vet you and you tell me that you're all in on Bernie, then you get to meet Howie Klein.
I voted for him. I voted for him last time. But it's just,
are you organizing for Bernie?
No, to be honest, I'm not.
Okay.
I'm not doing too much organizing. I don't organize it for anybody.
All right. I love you, buddy.
All right.
Stand in line for
I'll
one quick second. One second. Stand in line. One
okay.
second.
You're listening to the David Feldman Show, you happy, self-actualized hump.
Canada goes to the polls next week. Will Liberal leader Justin Trudeau retain his title? Let's find out. Let's go to Toronto, where Mark Breslin is standing by. Welcome, sir.
Hello. How are you doing, David?
Good. Now, what do you call Justin Trudeau? Would he be the world champion of Canada? What belt does he wear?
If you're he's the... In Canada, we call him the Crown Prince of Sorry. That is the highest distinction one can have here in this wonderful, wonderful country.
Well, you may have a prime minister whose wife wears a sari. I'm being serious. Tell me about Singh.
Jag, meet Singh. Singh, meet Jag.
It's a pitch.
I really like this guy. I really like this guy. He's elegant and he's balanced. He's not an attack dog. He's got a great... He's just not with the right party. The problem with the New Democratic Party, which is our kind of quasi-socialist party, is there's no bench strength. It's an entire party of school teachers. There's not a lot of people with a lot of great life experience. But Jagmeet himself, wonderful. Just wonderful.
Okay, let's slow down here because... If it's not happening in the United States, it doesn't exist. You have
no.
You're having the parliamentary elections next week.
Yeah.
And there are three parties. That's a Canadian cough, by the way. You hear that?
Thank you. Sorry, David.
Now don't you cough bilingually as well? You have to in Canada, right?
Don't I have to what?
Don't you have to cough bilingually? Don't you have to cough in English? And then you have to cough in French?
And cough in French? All coughs are French. When you think about it, because the French are such cigarette smokers, you just think of them coughing all the time. I once had a friend, and I'm not kidding about this, I had a friend who actually moved to Paris. And I said, you don't even speak French. Why are you moving to Paris? He said, so I can smoke in peace.
If you're from Quebec, are you part of some French commonwealth? Do you get... What is the relationship between Quebec and France?
None. In fact, if 1967, Charles de Gaulle came to Quebec and said, vive le Québec libre, live long live a free Quebec, and it caused... unbelievable chaos in the country. Unbelievable chaos. And it was very clear that he was trying to stir something up. But no, there is no official relationship between Quebec and France, except that Quebec often sends copies of Jerry Lewis movies over to France that when people don't want them anymore. But other than that, there's no real formal relationship whatsoever. Remember, the English beat the French in whatever war that was back in whenever that was, mm-hmm. in 17 something since something, and the French have never forgotten it. It's always been a source of contention. Quebec is always the exception to the rule. Quebec is always catered to in a special way. There are special language laws which are tolerated in Quebec. There's all kinds of stuff. We give them all kinds of transfer payments from other provinces to keep them happy. There's a tremendous guilt, I think, that came from winning that war way back when, and it's still being played out today. Now, you know that one of the five major parties is a Bloc Québécois, and it is basically an independence party. So here's people running for federal government whose goal is to dismantle the federal government if they could, and they never would be able to.
We call them Republicans here in America.
Yes, I believe you call them other things too.
Yes.
But So you have to remember that they have these referendums every 10 years about separating from the rest of Canada, and how that would ever actually happen, nobody really knows. But they never quite win. They come close all the time. It's always like 55% to 45%.
Is that every 10 years? Is it like on the books that every 10 years they're going to vote?
No. No, but every 10 years somebody whips up sentiment in Quebec saying, hey, you know what? We should be maîtres chez nous, which means masters of our own house.
And as nationalism spreads throughout the world, are we seeing Quebec wanting to secede?
But this has been going on for forever.
But is it being ginned up again? Is it being ginned up again?
Not this time, not this election, not particularly, but it will happen again. It's like a cycle.
And it's been violent at times, right? There's been terrorism.
There was terrorism, I remember, from the when the elder Trudeau was prime minister back in the 60s. There was a thing called the FLQ crisis, Front de Libération de Québec, which they used to plant bombs in mailboxes, which meant that Canadians could not deliver letters. But you know what? The post office is so lousy here, you couldn't tell the difference. they were kidnapping. They kidnapped two diplomats and shot them and stuck them in trunks.
Okay.
I think I can even remember the names of the guys. Richard Cross, who was a British diplomat, and Aldo Moro, I think, was the Italian diplomat.
Wait. Yeah. I thought Aldo Moro was kidnapped in Italy.
I'm wrong about that one. Sorry. I can't remember the other guy.
Okay. We're Aldo morons. So Jamit Singh he wears a turban. He's a Sikh, correct? He's from...
Yes, I believe he keeps his notes in the turban.
All right. No Karnak.
Nobody
jokes.
Else gets to do that.
Are you allowed to do that kind of joke in Canada, what you just said?
That's pretty mild.
Okay.
Would
he identify as a socialist? Would he identify as a socialist? Or do you have to in Canada? Does it matter to say you're a socialist?
Well, the New Democratic Party, look, I've said this before, I think everybody in Canada is somewhat of a socialist.
Right.
Because, you know, we have all these social nets and that nobody would ever dare dismantle, and those are socialist ideas. Often in Canada, progressive ideas start with the NDP, Socialist Party, and then kind of morph and move and are co-opted by liberal parties.
Okay.
And actually become legislation. But
so there are essentially three parties running in the parliamentary elections. The Liberal, that's Trudeau's party, the Conservative Party.
Correct.
Those are the two big ones. The New Democrats are coming up. They're a party from the 60s. Then you have the Green, the People's Party, and as you mentioned, the Bloc Québécois. And they have this big election because it's a parliamentary system. Depending on how many seats you win, you may or may not have to form a coalition with one of the other five parties.
And Jagmeet said today or yesterday, he said, I will not let the Conservatives become the next government. I will seek a coalition government with the Liberals.
Okay.
Usually politicians don't say that until after the election, but he said it before the election, which is very interesting.
And in a parliamentary system, which we don't have, say Trudeau's party doesn't...
Well, parliamentary systems depend on some level of literacy. Therefore, they would never work in the United States.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
You're absolutely right.
You know, it's Canadian Thanksgiving today, you know.
Is it really?
I didn't know that.
I did not know that.
Everybody has the day off to have turkey and beer, so...
And what are you thankful for other than not being American?
Oh, that's like that Jewish incantation which says, Shalom, Asami Isha, that didn't make me as a woman. What am I thankful for? Well, you know, what am I...
Wait, there's a prayer? There's a prayer to thank God for not making you a woman?
Yeah, that men say.
Well...
Men say that, and women, the equivalent one is, I can't remember it in Hebrew, but it's translated as thanks to the to God who made me as he wanted.
Ah, okay.
So in case you were wondering if Judaism had some level of patriarchy to it, just, you know, chew that one over for a while.
But it's run by women, essentially. I mean,
the home is run by women.
The home is run by women. You come home, you give the money to the wife, she puts you on an allowance, and you go to the back and read.
That's what my grandfather would have done. I guarantee it. Yep.
Yeah. Yeah, you're given an allowance. Okay, so there's the liberal, the conservatives, and the new Democrats. There's going to be an election.
Yeah.
Is it next Tuesday or Monday?
Next Monday.
Next Monday.
Like a week today.
A week from
today.
A week from today. Well, our show airs on Tuesday. And,
oh, I see.
So Trudeau can only be reelected prime minister if his party gets enough seats. If they don't get enough seats, then they have to form a coalition, as you mentioned, with the new Democrats, which means Trudeau has to be fungible. He then has to become more to the – he has to turn more to the left because he has to please the new Democrats.
Yes, but there's also another possible outcome, and that is that the conservatives could win enough seats to have a majority government and topple the current administration. It's unlikely with the polling that's going on that that will happen. The last polls, and by the way, the polls in Canada aren't nearly as sophisticated as the polls in the United States, where they're taking polls every day. There's Quinnipiac and all of those polls. In Canada, they don't poll as much. But the latest poll gave the Conservatives 145 seats and the Liberals 135 seats, and the rest were spread out amongst all the other parties. That's the 145 seats, though, would not be enough for somebody to have a majority government. I think that's 170.
Right. And Andrew Scheer is the leader of the Conservative Party.
He is. And why he's the leader of that party, I have no idea.
What is the? Go ahead.
He lied on his resume. Okay, we all lie on our resume, but he lied that he was a top insurance broker when he had never been an insurance broker. Now I ask you, David, who lies about being an insurance broker? Who would be proud to have been an insurance broker? That's the lie you're going to tell? What a yutz.
I have a question, speaking of insurance, and that's one of the issues that they're fighting out on Monday in the elections. Do you have health insurance in Canada?
Yes and no. We have basic health care, which is provided by the government, and I've said before, you don't get a bill. It just happens. But I also have extra premium health insurance that gives me things like guaranteed single room. It gives me a certain amount of dental care. It gives me a certain amount of prescription drugs for free. Well, not for free. It's paid for by the insurance. So you have different levels, and a lot of unions have them. If you're a union member, or if you're in certain kinds of companies, you can do it. You generally don't do it alone. It's too expensive, but you do it as part of a group of people, and you do a group package. Yes, you have extra. You have extra stuff, but very few. I don't know how many people have that. It's sort of semi-rare.
In America, we have the ruling class who's worried that Bernie's going to get elected and they're going to mow down our health care system. And
Bernie's not getting elected. But Elizabeth Warren might.
Well, we'll talk about that later. I disagree with you. But that he's going to mow down, or she's going to mow down, our health care system, and everybody's going to get the same equal treatment. As you've just pointed out, there will be a baseline of healthcare in America if we have Medicare for all. And then if you want more, like a single room, then you can buy an insurance package that gives you some, bump you up to business class or first class, right?
That's right. That's right. But understand that the things that I have on my insurance, my special insurance, which I get partially from ACTRA, which is like the equivalent of ACT-AGVA there in the States.
Oh, AFTRA.
The Performers Union.
Right,
AFTRA. Yeah, I get some coverage from them, and I get some coverage from my company, and I get little packages here and there. Understand that those things are not things that are essential.
They're perks. They're perks.
They're luxuries. If you want to pay for them, fine. You know, it's like if you can go to a basic doctor, or you can go to a doctor with beautiful art in the walls, and you right. have to pay extra for the art in the walls. So, you know, if it's important to you, then you do it.
Right. So that's more of an argument for the Canadian system.
Oh, David, come on. Of course, we all know that you're arguing for the Canadian system.
Well,
I love the Canadian system. There's no argument.
I know, but I was with two comedy writers over the weekend. Both I consider to be absolutely brilliant. They keep up on the issues. One of them said to me, I've heard that rich people in Canada come to America. They don't trust their Canadian doctors. If they have something serious, they make sure to come to New York or Massachusetts for the major surgery. And I said, that has to be anecdotal, and that has to be the guy who's worth $1 billion who doesn't know a $1,000 bottle of wine from a $20 bottle of wine, other than if it's $1,000, it must be good.
Well, I do have friends who are wealthy who do these holidays in Rochester, Minnesota at the big clinic, at the Mayo Clinic there. And when they go down and they have run-ups and really good meals in restaurants, and it's kind of like a spa holiday for these guys. And they find out about the conditions that they have. But then, interestingly enough, they don't stay down there to get those conditions treated. They go back to Canada and then say, look, I've got all this stuff wrong with me. You need to fix me up.
Interesting. Rich people, if you have money to burn, you want to feel special. You want to feel that you're getting ahead of the line, you're getting the best.
Well, there's no question. No matter that hospital, I mean, the Mayo Clinic it's just the best, and it doesn't matter that it happens to be in the States. It could be in France. It could be in Canada. You're just going somewhere which is the completely the best. I've had friends who've done this, and they say the attention is incredible, and the doctors are incredible. And you know, all doctors are good, but some doctors are better. And so what's the Carlin joke? You know, do you realize that somebody is doing medicine who graduated at the bottom of their class, and tomorrow someone has an appointment with him? Right. So, you know.
Yes, yes. So what are the kitchen table issues in Canada? Child care, climate change, guns, housing?
This election is not really being fought out very much on issues. It's being fought out on Trudeau himself as a character, as a personality, as a person who hasn't done what he said he was going to do, or has done things he hadn't said he was going to do. There have been a couple of scandals, some of which are so complicated I can't even comment on them. They're not sexual scandals or anything like that.
Involve the Attorney General?
They're procedural. They're procedural scandals. There's also, I mean, interestingly enough, the biggest thing that Trudeau did in his tenure is he legalized pot. And nobody is making that an issue and saying, well, we shouldn't have done it, or we have to think twice about this. Have we analyzed it? Everyone's leaving that one alone, because mm-hmm. I think it's become almost a motherhood issue in Canada. So no one's bothering him on that. But they're bothering him, you know, on this. That he's a hypocrite. There was a huge, huge ad taken out in all the newspapers a couple of days ago by some group which looks like it's a PC-driven group that just doesn't have the PC name on it, talking about how he's the hypocrite-in-chief and how what a hypocrite he is, how he's a hypocrite, and he's a rich kid who really doesn't care about things. And, yes, he'll appoint women to to his cabinet and have a gender parity cabinet, but they're incompetent, so what's the point? And there's a lot of stuff about him. A lot of it has become personal. He's not ready. There may be some truth to that. I actually think that Trudeau would be a great prime minister 5-10 years from now when he had some real experience. I think his inexperience does come out, mm-hmm. but he's still the best of the bunch.
Now, you have a carbon tax?
Yes.
You actually tax carbon. If somebody is emitting carbon, you are taxed. Yep. And how do they measure your carbon output? You run businesses.
Yes, but the kinds of businesses I run are not they're not big enough to be taxed. It's mostly for factories. So there's I don't know that much about it, frankly, because to be a staunch environmentalist, you have to go outside once in a while, and that's not me. So
they have a carbon
but
tax.
But I hear that there's a problem with the environment. By the way,
yes.
Anyway.
Oh my God.
I think in Scandinavia, isn't something?
I don't know either.
But I'm just telling you what I heard.
we may bleep that.
Well, you may if you like.
Can you say that?
I just did. It's a joke. I didn't do it. It's a joke.
And any repercussions from Louis? Any complaints? Anything? It never happened?
Nothing. I'm telling you, there was nothing. There were, of course, some people who commented negatively on social media, and then they would immediately get barraged and hit by 100 other people saying, "What are you nuts? It's time." Or, "He never did anything that bad in the first place." Or, "I don't care what kind of a bad guy he is. I want to see his comedy."
Right.
So, no, there was nothing. I will only say this. One last thing on Louis C.K. I figured out what he could have done to make all of this go away.
Yeah.
If you're going to have any kind of a... here's what I've learned in my life. I'm 67 years old. I've been married for 20 years. But before that, I was quite active socially. And I will only say this. Women see everything as a relationship. And if you want to not make them angry about anything, make sure you frame everything you do as a relationship. That Louis, after each encounter with each of these women, the next day he should have sent them flowers and a note saying, "Had a great time. If I'm in town the next time, I can't wait to see you. Thanks for a great evening." Nothing would have happened.
Okay. Women view everything as a relationship.
Sorry?
Women view everything as a relationship.
Yeah, they want a relationship, and it's kind of insulting to to have some kind of sexual event with somebody, no matter, even if it's not real sex, if it's like the ultimate form of safe sex, even so, it's sexual, and you have to respond by making them not feel diminished. Women feel diminished by just having sex with somebody, anybody, and everybody, as it turns out. That's another crime that he committed, is he wasn't monogamous. If it was monogamous, women love that, So if he had just done this to one woman, it would have been, "Wow, I'm special. Look at that. He feels like I'm so attractive." Yeah, but then they find out he does it with everybody. It's like, "Oh, I'm nobody." And nobody likes to feel like nobody.
Right. Right.
Those are my last words on the topic.
And thank God we don't have a woman here to refute any of this. But I interviewed...
Why do you think I'm doing your podcast? Come on.
I interviewed a Harvard doctor. He came up with a paleo diet. And And he says, he wrote a book about this, that women, again... they really don't want one-night stands. Now, again, this is another man mansplaining what women want. And this probably soothes men to hear this. But the theory is that when women have one-night stands, they're really still searching for something biologically.
I'm not a scientist, so I can't say. I can only speak out of personal experience, and I can say that there's just not enough gentlemanliness in the world.
I agree with you.
And when women say, and Me Too people say, that men can't read the room, boy, are they right.
Yeah.
I have a friend I go out with for dinner. He's my age. He's, like, pushing 70. And he flirts with the waitress. Always. He always has to flirt with the waitress. Okay, you know what? He's an entertaining guy, and they don't seem to mind. It's okay. Fine. And then he says to me, look, you go pay the bill. I'm going to go get her number.
Wow.
And I say, she's like 30, 40 years younger than you. Why? She likes me. No, it's her job to like you. And you know what? Maybe she does like you. But just because she likes you doesn't mean she's going to spread for you. No, why are you doing this? No. So I go out and I pay the bill and I wait outside. And inevitably, he comes out and I said, well, did you get her number? He said, no, she wasn't really interested.
But.
They just don't read it.
But he loves.
Yeah.
He loves that moment. He lives. There's a thrill. It's the dog chasing the car.
Yeah, and I'll never understand that because, frankly, if the dog can't chase the car, the dog should just lie around and look at a stick. I don't get it because I hate rejection so much, and I always did, that if I wasn't pretty sure that I was going to get a yes, I just wouldn't ask the question.
Okay, back to politics.
Yeah.
Do you guys worry about Trump? Are you as anxious as we are, or do you feel it's you're just immune from his madness?
Somewhere in between, because we think it's only a matter of time, perhaps, that some crazy idea he has will actually affect this country directly, or get you guys into a war, which drags us into a kind of warlike situation. You'd be hard pressed to find many Donald Trump apologists in Canada. Even people who would have some affinity for the Republican Party would not feel that way. If we have Republicans here, they're Mitt Romney type Republicans.
Right. So they don't tell you what they're really thinking.
Well, yeah, and no. No, they're people who believe in, you know, less governments, smaller taxes, the sort of traditional conservative things, not this crazy stuff that he does.
Okay. I will give you the last word on this issue because you said that Bernie can't win. Bernie gave an interview with.
I didn't say that Bernie can't win. I didn't. I said Bernie won't have the nomination.
Okay. I'm going to say something, and then you get the last word on Bernie. He gave an interview on Sunday with ABC News, and they're constantly asked. You know, there's really no difference between you and Elizabeth Warren, so people should just vote for Elizabeth Warren because she's younger. More likable. She checks off more boxes than you do. There's really no difference, so why not vote for Elizabeth Warren? And Bernie said, there are differences between Elizabeth and myself. Elizabeth, I think, as you know, has said that she is a capitalist through her bones, and I am not. Now, then you get the last word. The American people...
Well,
hang on for one second. Let me just state this, and then you get the last word. The American people love strange. And I believe the Democrats will go for a socialist because it's different. And they're angry at capitalism. And they know that nobody's going to convert this country to a capitalist, to a socialist nation. But it would be nice to have a socialist voice somewhere in our government. I see the American people voting for Bernie Sanders saying, let's try this.
Well, I think 4 years ago they would have, had he gotten the nomination rather than Hillary. And I think 4 years ago, there's a really good chance he might have been president. But I just don't think it's his year. I just don't feel the momentum. I feel that Elizabeth has the momentum, and I'm not even going to say that she'll get it. That it could just go to Biden, just like it started. You know, nothing will change, and that's a possibility, too. And that's actually, I think, the most profound possibility. But I just don't think Bernie's... I think he had his real moment 4 years ago. That was his real moment.
As somebody who books,
I love Bernie. I love his ice cream. I think it's fantastic. Him and his partner, Jerry. the two of them make a phenomenal ice cream up there in Vermont. But I just don't think he's the guy this year. And the heart attack didn't help.
Okay. You and I have been following comedy since either one of us was born. There are comedians who would do 50 shots on The Tonight Show. They would get 50 HBO specials, and they'd come to a town near you and not sell an effing ticket. And yet they had the full weight of the industry behind them. And then there were these comedians who just bubbled up to the surface. And you wake up one day, and they're selling out Madison Square Garden, and the gatekeepers are thinking, well, where did this person come from? The gatekeepers give us this narrative about Bernie, but he may be Russell Peters.
Maybe not a good comparison, if you know Russell Peters, but
why?
Nevertheless.
Why is it a...
Russell's... First of all, Russell's got a way bigger following in Sri Lanka than he does in the States. Russell sells, 100,000 seats in Sri Lanka, but he might only sell 3,000 seats in the States. So I'm not sure that was the best example you could have used. But I understand what you're saying. But my gut feeling is that it's not Bernie's year.
Okay.
And I don't think next time is Bernie's year either. I think that's really pushing it.
Right. What are you reading before you go?
Haven't been doing much reading. I was very busy this week. I did a show I do every year called Humor Me, and it's actually one of the few new formats I've ever seen in stand-up comedy. 7 years ago, it was started by a guy named David Goodman, who's a comic. But he was also president of a bank. His parents have a bank. He's a very wealthy guy, but he's also a comic. And what he did was he went to four CEOs, I mean real CEOs of major companies, banks and railroads and things like that, and said, I will challenge you to do 4 minutes of stand-up in front of 1,000 people. And to do so, you will raise money for a cause, usually a children's cause, a children's hospital. And then there'll be a panel on stage, of which I'm the Simon Cowell of this panel, David. And mm-hmm. They'll make fun of you, and somebody will win this cup. But it's all for a good cause. And we've been doing this for 7 years, and each year we raise somewhere between $1.5 and $2 million in one night.
Wow.
I know. So
how do people buy tickets for this? How do my listeners participate?
Well, they're $1,000 a piece, and I don't think they're even for sale to the public. They're all done through these CEOs and their companies. So the people in their companies, either the guy will buy, 300 seats and distribute them to the people who work for him, mm-hmm. or they will buy somehow from the company things. But they're not on a website where you can just go and buy a seat.
Right. And I would assume you're very kind.
Oh yeah! No, it is exciting, really exciting to be able to really make fun, brutal fun of millionaires and even billionaires that are mm-hmm. up there. So the people get off on that because in many cases they're watching their boss. They can't say anything bad to their boss, but I can because I don't work for them.
Right.
And the other two people on the panel, they're just milder. They're still funny, but they're just milder in their humor.
Okay, last question. Who wins next Monday in Canada? What happens?
One of two things will happen. First of all, it will be a minority government. No one will win a majority. I suspect it will be Andrew Scheer, the Conservatives, who will win a slightly higher number of seats.
Really?
It could still be the Liberals. Because as great as Jagmeet has been, his numbers don't go up. He does fantastic on the debates. He was the best thing on the debates, easily.
But you don't have the vitriol and anger that we have, right?
It's not really. No.
Do you have a, you don't have a Fox News ginning up contempt?
No, no, no. We have nothing like that. We have nothing like that here.
And you have laws, for example, preventing, say, Facebook from accepting ads that are lies about your opponent?
I don't know, but I don't think so. I don't think so.
You're allowed to lie in a parliamentary race?
It's done all the time.
Okay, great.
Mark, all the time.
Mark Breslin is the founder and president of Yuck Yucks, the world's largest comedy chain. Can you stand the line, sir?
Yes.
It's time for our comedy virus. Let's all welcome Dave Sirus.
Let's go to Atlanta, Georgia, where comedian and comedy writer Dave Sirus is standing by. Last week, you had to talk to us in a closet because there was a Hollywood party going on in Atlanta. Is it still?
I was just in a bedroom. I just thought you'd feel better if I said I was in a closet.
Is that party still happening? Has it ended?
Not here. Not here. Now the place is all empty. Just the remnants of party.
And how was that party? How long did it go until?
It really wasn't a party, David. It was just people enjoying each other's, let's say, company.
Beautiful people, though. Beautiful actresses and actors who are accustomed to letting their guard down and just being honest with one another. No inhibitions, right?
None. I mean, we're all friends.
So no hang-ups.
Nothing that you need to have reverence for, if that's what you mean.
And they're free with their bodies.
Well, I mean, you kind of have to be an actor. You have to be free and know how to, you know, be open and express oneself. So, yes, I'd say they're pretty free with their bodies.
To them, sex is like a bodily function. It's just a release.
They're describing sex. Yeah. I mean, sex is a bodily function. It is literal release of tension.
It's an emotional connection that ends after everybody's been satisfied. The next day, you go back to the set. It's as though it never happened. Nobody possesses one another, right?
Mm-hmm.
It must be great to be part of that scene, Dave Sirus.
I mean, does observing count?
Don't tell me that.
I mean, I cannot say for certain. Look, I get it. You've been in Hollywood for a long time, and you've been to a ridiculous number of orgies. So for you, you know, this is old hat. I get it. I get that, you know, this is the old world. You were doing this kind of thing, you know, back when it counted, you know, the 80s. You know, people were getting AIDS.
Mm-hmm.
You were right there watching it happen. You know, you were all over the scene. You were going to orgies back when that meant something, when you were really risking your life.
Yes, yes. Well, speaking of STDs, we should mention that Dave Sirus writes for many television shows, many great comedians. He writes movies, and you wrote something for Saturday Night Live. Saturday night.
Well, I mean, I assisted with something. I often help my buddy Pete with his update features. That was one of my main responsibilities when I worked there, and I very often will write things together for the show.
And you're coming under attack.
To be perfectly honest, this is not an attack. It's really more, you know, when you work in the news, you have to think of things to say. So in many ways, I'll say this before I say it. In many ways, this is maybe just a message for people who didn't quite get it, which is fine. But I see right before we go on, I just see an article that says, what Pete Davidson is wrong about STDs. Why Pete Davidson's wrong about STD? Because we did write this thing together that was basically, you know, a very ironic tongue-in-cheek argument about why it's great that only the curable diseases, STDs, are the ones on the rise. You know, the ones that are bacteria you can, you know, cure with antibiotics. And the article, and I'm looking at this article, I'm like, it's almost as if they don't. It's almost as if he said these things that were intentionally untrue and terrible with an ironic twist so that you could get something out of it, such as laughter or learning something. Like, it's a goddamn joke.
Well, I didn't see.
He's not saying it's good that people have gonorrhea.
I didn't That's see it. Joke. What was the message? What were you saying?
Well, the joke was just the over-exaggeration. You know, I hate talking about joke writing, but yeah, the joke was, he's like, what's the problem here? All the diseases that are on the rise are the ones you can cure. You know what I'm hearing? Great job, science. Like, that's essentially, you know, mm-hmm. and then the bit goes other places. But that was basically just the dumb joke of it. And I just find it so funny that, like, we have to take everything seriously. Like, nothing can be a joke.
Well, was and he then, reckless? Was he telling kids not to wear condoms?
No. He specifically said, one of the lines is, I'm saying you should wear a condom, but since you won't, go to your doctor and get some antibiotics. So that's the joke. The joke is, he's saying, look, I know you idiots aren't going to wear condoms. You should, but you won't. So here's what you got to do. It's ghoulish overkill. That's the goddamn joke. I just find it so funny that, like, you have to have just an article about, well, you know, if you left untreated, it can lead to infertility. And it's like, yeah, he said get the shot.
Well, you were normalizing going bareback.
I feel like that's already been normalized for the most part. People do it. I feel like it happens every day somewhere.
Right, but as a broadcaster, you have a responsibility to remind people to wear condoms at all times, even while listening to the show.
Mm-hmm. I know, you know, we included that too. It's just, you know, the point, sometimes you have to say things satirically, and it's, and I'm not saying there's anything wrong with having an article being like, well, you know what, now that we started the conversation, let's give people facts. I agree with that entirely. It's just the idea of, there is that weird thing where people keep acting like they don't know when you're kidding. And that happens a lot. And the weirdest thing is how, like, it also goes in the other direction, where in that same way where people take things seriously, then people will do things that should be taken seriously, specifically, like, it's a very alt-right thing to do something that should be taken seriously, and they'd be like, oh, it's just a joke.
Mm-hmm.
And it's weird how they, like, manipulate that sort of – it's just like cheat codes, just sort of crippling culture step by step by taking everything that people have and exploiting it. And in this case, it's people's lack of sense of humor. And they then exploit that to say, oh, you don't have a sense of humor, and that's why you think, you know, it's offensive when Trump says things that he means literally true, and then we pretend it's a joke.
Okay, now I'm not trying to brag, but one of the reasons you like to do my show is for the exposure. I am the 450,000th most popular podcast in America, and that carries with it a burden, responsibility. I know that there are things that I say that people might misconstrue and then act upon. Now, I would assume that SNL has more viewers than I have listeners.
I don't know.
Yeah, that would be. I wouldn't be surprised, though. Right.
Right. I mean, anything's possible.
Anything's possible. I'm gonna guess that it's on NBC. It has more viewers than I have listeners. If one or two people come away from your segment with the thought, you know what? I don't need to wear a condom. I can just go get it treated. And, you know, is syphilis ever cured?
Yes.
I thought you never get rid of it.
No. If you have it till the third, like, stage, you're bad. But no, if you get – these are all bacterial infections that you should be getting tested for and should be treating if you have them. That's okay. Sort of the main point we're making. But also, I think it's important.
Well, what about herpes? Herpes is like a diamond, isn't it?
Well, yes, herpes is forever, but also herpes is not one of the ones that was on the rise. That's – the joke of it is the only STDs that were on the rise were the ones you can cure. That was the impetus of the joke, and saying that, well, that seems like that's a win for science. It's a dumb joke, but it's clear. And then you'd go places from there, but that's, you know, it's just a premise for a comedy bit. And
What if I told you somebody watched your little piece on SNL and then turned it off, turned to his girlfriend and had unprotected sex?
Mm-hmm. Well, now you know she's cheating on you.
What do you mean?
You got something.
No. What happens if they have unprotected sex?
Uh-huh.
And they have a baby?
God forbid.
They have a baby together.
Then we created, then we did something wonderful. Here's the thing. I'm very comfortable in the position that if anyone finds us responsible for doing something wrong, then when they explain why they did it, they're going to say the word, well, why did you have unprotected sex? And they're going to say, well, I saw Pete Davidson say, and that's where they're going to stop listening. Because if that's the reason you made that decision, I don't think anyone's going to hold Pete responsible. People should not be taking his, should not be basing their lives on jokes he makes.
Do you worry that maybe you're a coastal elitist who has contempt for the flyover people?
It's not just them.
How's Georgia? What do you do to relax in Atlanta?
Well, like I said before, you know, we have a very nice place that they put us up in. So I've been playing with the Oculus. I've been doing VR, and I just had a lot of work to do. And, you know, just hanging out, enjoying comfort foods, you know, all the foods you would have eaten if you worked, you know, 14 hours a day outside, but you don't.
Mm-hmm. Oculus is virtual reality. So are you walking into like horror movies? What are you doing?
Well, no, it's basically like, it's like a video game, except that you're inside the world. So like your body is in, it's immersive. So it's like you look around with your head and you're looking around a 3D room, and you know, you can just do games, or you can do like be on a roller coaster, or be like walking a tightrope or something. It's really cool. It's
how much time can you spend with Oculus until you start getting dizzy and disoriented?
I've never had that issue.
How many hours can you be in a virtual reality?
Well, just till I get bored. I mean, it's like any other. It's like any other video game. I'm going to play it for an hour, and then I'm going to be, you know, tired of it for a while.
I was freaked out. Somebody showed me kind of like a horror movie where I could walk through a haunted house.
Yeah, they have those.
I got really creeped out and scared.
That's good. It worked.
But discombobulated. And now they have found that phones alter our brains. Are you worried that Oculus might alter your brain?
No. I mean, you know, that's the direction I want my brain to go, whatever the Oculus does to it. I feel like, you know, you got to live your life. You can't go around worrying that, you know, your brain is going to do this or that.
Is there Oculus porn yet?
I don't think there's like actual made for the Oculus porn, but I think there's like regular, like there is VR porn you can just put into, like, you know what I mean? Like, I think there's a lot of stuff you can get for the Oculus that works on a phone too, just not as well. So I think there are VR Oculus, but not like actual manufactured for the Oculus.
And how many years away are we from Inception?
I mean, Inception is specific to dreams. I mean, that's about like the idea that we could physically recreate someone's thoughts is not there yet. And I have no idea how long that's going to be.
But the idea that you could be not sedated with an Oculus, but to put on these glasses and be transported to another.
Oh, on that level, we're a few years away. On that level, I would say in 10 years, you should be completely inside a world that you forget is not real, that is indistinguishable from your real one.
And you can spend the rest of your life inside of it.
Well, I mean, no, because it's still just a game. You know, I mean, the argument that that line of thought about, like, would you just spend the rest of your life? That was the same thing people probably once said about the book. You know, be like, oh, you're just going to live your whole life in some other story. Like, it's on that level, it's essentially the same thing. I don't think there's any real danger that you still have to, like, eat and go to the bathroom and have a job. What people do in the recreation is whatever.
But, like, you know, if I choose to just eat donuts and stay in bed and wear the Oculus headset,
you're not going to reproduce. And so you'll be weeded out.
I'll be weeded out, but I'd say I give up. I can't stand my life, so give me some donuts, and I'm going to live in a reality. I'm going to live in The Godfather. I'm going to live in the compound with Don Corleone,
and watch them all day and interact with Sonny and Luca Brasi.
I don't see any reason why that couldn't just be what you replace watching TV with. I mean, let's face it. Some people are watching 14 hours of TV a day already.
But I would get to talk to them. Wouldn't I interact with them?
Yeah, no, it'd be awesome. And you'll probably love it. And it'll be, and I don't see the problem. I think it would probably make it easier to work long, hard hours if your leisure was that focused.
So theoretically, I could say, I want to go to Vegas with Michael and hang out with Johnny Fontaine.
Yeah, why not?
And they could create that universe for me.
Of course. Isn't that the world you want to live in? Where you get to do stuff like that? Isn't that worth it for all the horrors of the world to have that too? To have, you know, at least there's an upside of technology and the slow march to death that we're doing in this world.
And I could have a conversation with Mo Green and he'd give me some chips and I could play.
Well, yeah. I mean, the problem is you'd have to figure out how to replicate the voices well. But yeah, you can basically do that.
Oh, I think right now they have AI that can take Marlon Brando's voice and get all the A's and the E's and the consonants.
It's there, but you also need to have people who – it's kind of hard to do without the person giving you every word you need first. But yeah, there's stuff they can do, but I don't know if it would be interactive where every single word they need would work. And you know, you have to understand that like this stuff has to be built. You'd have to have a writer sit around and decide everything someone would say. There's no AI that can replicate, you know, a character's conversation.
Yeah.
We're not there
yet.
At all. I mean, hopefully we do. I mean, I think that, you know, it would be great if we had, you know, artificial intelligence because it's not going to have the flaws of our human intelligence. You know, I think that if I was creating an artificial intelligence right now, I'd want it to have all the nuclear codes. I'd want it to have all the passwords that the president has, you know, so he doesn't lose them. I think that.
And you would trust AI to make the appropriate decisions. And yet we're discovering that driverless cars may not ever happen.
Well, that's in many ways a good thing. But
if we can't trust AI to drive a car, why would you trust AI with the launch codes?
Well, I would trust AI. I would trust artificial intelligence with launch codes because all you have to do is program it in such a way that it wouldn't want to do anything bad. So what I would do if I was making AI, you would give it access to all our nuclear weapons because you want to be able to react instantly, you know, if something happens. But you also make sure the AI knows that its number one priority is to self-preserve, to protect its own life. And that way it would never do anything crazy like bomb anybody. You got to make sure that the artificial intelligence or the robot, its number one priority is protecting itself.
But somebody could hack it.
I mean, I guess. But it would be so worried about protecting itself, I imagine it would, you know, fight back if someone wanted to make it do something evil. Oh, yeah. I would just say don't do anything evil. But always protect your own life.
And Google.
Always.
Look how Google's.
Protect its own life.
Google's motto is don't do anything evil.
Don't be evil.
Yeah. And that's worked for them.
Well, they did expunge that from all their records. I don't know if you know that. They did remove that from everything.
Tonight is the big debate.
Yes, that is technically, it is tonight if you're listening. This came out. We got one more debate, and then I'm sure everything will be settled.
Well, I think Biden goes down. I think – this is what I think. I think
– He's limping in.
He's limping in. I think – Bernie is going to say one or two things, and he'll get a bump in the polls. Mm-hmm. And I think Elizabeth Warren will go down a little.
Because you want her to? Because you see her as the real threat now?
I would vote for Elizabeth Warren.
I know you would. But right now, she's your enemy.
She's not my enemy. She's not
right now, I feel like her and Biden are who you want to have bad days because it helps Bernie.
Mm-hmm.
And look, I've told you, I like Bernie, too. I would certainly be happy if he was the candidate. But the heart attack hurts. You know that.
I think it helps.
Biggest question.
I think it helps.
because they're looking at him, because now he has the opportunity to show how not debilitated he is.
And it humanizes him. He's a curmudgeon, and it makes him vulnerable and lovable.
I think it hurts Biden. I think Bernie's heart attack hurts Biden more than it hurts Bernie, because when it comes to Biden, you know, Bernie does seem very healthy, and his heart attack apparently was very minor, but it reminds people about age. And if you're going to attack Bernie for his age, you have to attack Biden also. And they kind of pull each other down in that way. And like we've said, if you're someone who loved Bernie and now you think that he may not be the candidate as viable a candidate as you want, I would be very surprised if you went to Biden instead of Elizabeth. Elizabeth feels like the appropriate person to get those votes. And I've always felt like Elizabeth and Bernie were splitting a vote that could dwarf Biden's. I always felt like they have similar people, and that the only reason Biden was winning was because those two were splitting the left half of the party.
Right. What if people aren't voting based on policy? Because, you know, second choices in the Democratic Party, the polling is fascinating, where people go after Biden.
Well, unfortunately, on both sides, it is very commonly just a personality contest, and people are voting about what somebody looks like. And that's
or terrifying. Authenticity.
Well, authenticity is a problem because people aren't psychic, and it's very sad how much people think that they can look someone in the eye and know what they're thinking when they can't.
But who do you think is the most authentic? Who's real? Who has been unmovable, immutable?
Bernie, probably.
Yeah.
But I think when you compare him in that way to someone like Warren, it's not enough to make the difference in terms of if there's other things about her you like. I think that she seems extremely competent and extremely ready in a way that I don't think any other candidate really shows. And I think Elizabeth's there, and she's also attracted to people who don't think that the country would survive or tolerate as much change as Bernie wants. And I think that probably isn't true. It probably isn't true that the country can't deal with it. Obviously, he's not going to accomplish everything he wants. No president does. But I see Elizabeth as a very attractive candidate, particularly to the people who are voting for the right reasons. I think a lot of people vote on wrong reasons, and they vote based on, like I said, personality. And I think the problem with authenticity is that you're usually making a guess.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people in this country thought the most cartoonish, pathological liar in American political history was authentic.
What if there's a groundswell for Bernie that the pollsters are missing and the coastal elites don't see?
What do you mean, what if?
What if, you know, these polls don't mean anything, and in Iowa, New Hampshire, Bernie wins big, and there's this tsunami of people who say, you know, I myself am not a socialist, but I wouldn't mind one in the Oval Office. I think that's a distinct possibility. I think it is very conceivable that...
I don't have that much confidence in the American people to know what democratic socialism even means.
I don't think they need to know what it means. They don't know what capitalism means, but they do know that they're not participating in this economy, and they wouldn't mind somebody coming in and shaking things up the way Trump was supposed. Well, he did shake things up.
He shook things up just in a terrible direction, and he was ineffectual with everything, you know, that he really wanted to do. The problem with Bernie, though, is that a lot of the people who want that change just don't believe he can move the needle. That's the problem. And that the difference between – people say the difference between Bernie and Warren is that Warren has plans and Bernie's all about getting the people behind it. But I don't know if I have the confidence in the people's capacity to get behind anything.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know that we have that in us anymore.
Right. Well, you're a screenwriter.
Right? Sure. Yeah.
That's a plan. Mm-hmm. That's a great plan. I wrote a movie, and it's a plan.
But it takes somebody to implement it. It takes a Bernie to say, okay, good plan, but we're going to be, you know, I've been reading about Roosevelt. And the reason Roosevelt succeeded is he had a million plans, and he just kept saying, let's try this, let's try this, let's throw this against the wall, we'll throw this again. We'll just keep trying the things that work, we'll keep the things that don't work, we won't, but I have a moral compass, I know what I'm trying to do here.
A lot of people in this country love everything about Bernie, but they have people in their lives around that age, and that can screw with their ability to trust him also. I'm not saying it's fair. I'm not saying it's right. You know, the same thing happened to John McCain, and we found out that had John McCain beaten Barack Obama, he would have finished his two terms without a hint of dementia or physical problems, right?
And then dropped dead a year later.
Well, yeah, but the point is he would have been fine. Bob Dole, as it turns out, would have been just fine, and was another guy that we gave a lot of crap for his age.
Mm-hmm.
Bernie is a lot older than either of those people were when they were running. And at some point, it simply becomes impossible to deal with, because we're talking about a president in his mid-80s is what we'd be talking about by the second term. And, I mean, a lot of us have people in our lives that age, and as much as we love them, we recognize that they can't quite keep up as much as they used to. You know, 60-year-olds will tell you they can't keep up with 40-year-olds.
I don't know.
To be 80 years old and be at the level you have to be an effective president, to run for president, you have to be very exceptional physically. Bernie very well may be. But it's a question mark for people. And it's not wrong of them to have that question. It's not ageist. No one lives forever. And yeah, I wish Bernie was younger. I do. And I like Bernie. I've liked Bernie since before he ran in 2016. But you can't act like people are monsters for saying, shit, I think he's too old. And Elizabeth Warren's right there.
And okay.
She's enough. And you know what? Like, I'm sorry
young people love Bernie.
We do.
No, not even you. I'm talking about 20-year-olds.
No, I know. Young people love Bernie, and they should. And they should – of course they should love him. It doesn't mean they think that he's the best candidate.
They do.
Right now.
That's the thing.
A lot of people do love him, but they still – well, they love him because if you have a purity test for your candidate, he wins. Because in the test of who 30 years ago had the wokeness of today, Bernie wins, right, for most – you know, topics. And a lot of people only care about that purity. A lot of people only care about making sure the candidate they pick is the absolute one that they have the most trust in. And I kind of hate the general idea in this country that we have to like our politicians. Like, the problem with Trump was that people wanted to be excited. And I'm like, no, you shouldn't be excited at all. You should be bored. That's what a normal president's supposed to be like.
Bernie told somebody to shut their baby up.
Yeah, I saw that. Well, he didn't say shut the baby up. He was a little bit easier than that. I saw the clip. He didn't actually say that. Look, I like the guy. And I personally would have no problem with him being president. You have to accept that at some age, it becomes a really big issue. I know people in their mid-80s. I know a few people in their mid-80s. It's really hard for me to picture them having a job with that much responsibility. I'm very close with multiple people who are the exact age Bernie will be when he finishes his first term.
Clint Eastwood.
Yeah, Clint Eastwood. You want to – the guy who screamed at the empty chair.
Mick Jagger. Bruce Springsteen.
How old is Bruce Springsteen?
71.
Okay, well, he's young enough.
You don't think Bruce Springsteen at 80 is still going to be touring in 10 years? You don't think he's still going to be doing four-hour shows? Elton John's quitting, but Mick Jagger? Mick Jagger had a heart issue, and he was back at him.
Yeah, you can be on autopilot and play your songs. It's not the kind of thinking you're going to do as president.
What do you think is harder? being Mick Jagger.
Being president.
No, I think being Mick Jagger.
Oh, my God. Stop it. That's what Trump thought the presidency was going to be. He thought it would be sitting around taking pictures with Girl Scouts. It's a really hard goddamn job. That's why everyone who's not, well, Bush or Trump ages terribly in the job. People who actually do the job age horribly.
What did you think of Ellen DeGeneres befriending George W. Bush?
That was an interesting one. One thing I'll say about that, first of all, is that whatever your opinion is, you have to be right about the facts of the matter. So I saw so many people claiming that she accepted an invitation into George Bush's luxury box, which is not what happened. She accepted an invitation from the owner who also invited the Bushes, right? So it wasn't – I think there's a big difference between accepting that invitation and just sitting there and, oh, my God, George W. Bush is sitting next to me. I totally agree that he is someone who should be remembered as history's greatest monster. Well, up to, you know, the last few years. But I also feel like there is this – it's very easy for you – on your couch to say, I would have made a scene.
Right.
And I think a lot of people are really full of shit when it comes to what they would have done in blank situation. I agree with you. Midway. I think that, you know, she didn't need to be that effusive. She didn't need to call him her friend, but she also did not need to storm out of there and say, you didn't do anything for gay rights as Republican president years before gay rights became a big issue.
Right.
I mean, we have to be like, it's like saying, if you got to meet George Washington, would you spit in his face because he owned slaves, or would you want to have a conversation with George Washington?
So what are the cultural forces underneath this dust up? I see some. I see identity politics at play here. I see people saying, you see, there's a lesbian who calls herself a liberal, but she's not so liberal.
Well, it's about people and this brinksmanship of their politics, where there's nothing in it for anyone to be the slightest bit moderate or reasonable. Like, there's no incentive for anyone to be anything but extreme. But like I said, it's because we're listening to people who have nothing to lose saying all the wonderful things they'd do if they had those things to lose.
And yet George W. Bush is a monster. Right?
Yeah, he is. He is a monster. But I don't expect Ellen to be the one to make that argument in the middle of a football game.
Okay, but you do understand that people have a right to attack her for sitting there and making nice and goofing around with a monster.
Are we mad at Michelle Obama for doing it?
That's different. That was ceremonial.
No, that's what I'm saying. I'm saying, how different is this? And I am agreeing. If it was me, I know that I would not have been I certainly would not have been as friendly, but I also would have comported myself like an adult, and I would have shaken hands with the man and said, pleasure to meet you, and then gone back to my friends and be like, I can't believe I shook his fucking hand. Like, that's what a normal person does. You're polite in public.
Yeah.
I get that she wanted – there's a certain kind of person that even if they're in the room with a monster, they don't want to be rude. And I don't think that everyone has an obligation to be rude. She could have scaled it back a little, but I think people are being a little bit of babies about saying what they would have done and about the giant scene they would have made.
Right. Well, I think it's good for people to be upset about it and for it to be discussed. I like saying Bill Clinton being friendly with the Bushes and the Obamas being friendly with the Bushes, because when you look at Syria or any place where there's a civil war going on, at the top, it's calming to see, for example, Tip O'Neill attacking Ronald Reagan and then having a drink with him at the end of the day.
Yes, I agree.
That's good for the...
Absolutely, I agree.
Yeah. However,
miss those days.
However, what has happened is there are no more consequences for bad behavior in Washington, D.C. The idea that George W. Bush can rehabilitate his name, that, you know, Liz Cheney now is
number three in the Republican leadership. Jenna Bush is on the Today Show. There should be consequences.
Let's be fair, though. Donald Trump rehabilitated George Bush's image. That is why people are nice to George Bush now, by comparison. If there wasn't for Donald Trump, we would still remember George Bush as the worst president in modern American history.
Right.
That the way that people treat Bush now is a direct result of the unbelievable comparison between them. So you can't leave that out either. I am one of the people who constantly thinks about, God, I hate how much Bush looks good just because Trump exists. But if being nice to Bush makes Trump feel bad, I'm okay with it.
Right. Right.
Because we do need people. We need Republicans to look and be like, yeah, you see how even that idiot warmonger is better? You see how even that is more acceptable, and that we can have a conversation with even that compared to this? So that complicates things a lot.
Okay. Well, Dave Sirus, always a pleasure. I'm sure you have a big Hollywood party to go to.
No, just Atlanta Hollywood parties.
How's the food?
I wanted to go to a real southern Atlanta place today, and it was not good. So I'm very disappointed. I really wanted my last time to be the most comforting of comfort foods.
And Atlanta this time of year is getting cold.
It's been hot as hell, and it just got cold, so it's nice.
Okay. How do people follow you on Instagram?
Dave, DaveSirus.
Okay. Stay on the line, Dave Sirus.
It's time for our comedy virus. Let's all welcome Dave Sirus.